Welcome to today evening's program, where we have the first the convener, Dr. Ritu Khanna. She is Director Khanna Medical Center Fertility Clinic in Varanasi. She is currently the chairperson-elect Foxy Food and Drug Medico-Surgical Equipment Committee. She is the Secretary Society of Fetal Medicine Varanasi Chapter, Vice Chairperson Women's Doctor Wing IMA Benares Branch. She has held many other positions, primarily Vice President WOGS, Secretary WOGS, Joint Treasurer, Indian Fertility Society, Co-Convener, SIG IFS Ultrasound, and many more. May I request Dr. Ritu to kindly take the proceedings forward.
Thank you so much for this kind words. Namaskar and a very good evening to all of you. It's an honor and pleasure to welcome each one of you for being here on this focused academic webinar on confusion to clarity in adenomyosis. The heart, mind, and soul behind this program is none other than our energetic, dynamic Vice President Foxy, Dr. Ramani Devi Ma'am, and the unflinching support by the Chair Foxy Endometriosis Committee, another very energetic and ever-smiling Dr. Asha Rao Ma'am. The aim here is to discuss the evidence-based recommendations to hold clarity, which form an important part of our day-to-day practice. And today, we are really honored to have the authorities in their respective fields, Dr. Manju Khemani, Dr. Asha Rao, Dr. Vidya Bhatt, as our guest speakers, and the young dynamic stars, Saumil Trivedi and Dr. Rohan Krishnakumar, as the presenters, and the stalwarts, Dr. Muralidhar Pai and Dr. Nagendra Sardesh Pandey, as our experts. To have legendary figures as our chief guest, Dr. Suchitra Pandit Ma'am, and the guest of honor, Dr. Lakshmi Shirakhande, to bless us on this day is a real moment of pride and privilege for us. And we are deeply humbled and honored by their presence. And I'm sure that this session will really be thought-provoking and bubbling with queries and will be a platform to meet amazing people wrapped up with lot of carry-home messages. With these words, now I invite our chief guest, who is a globally renowned legendary figure, an inspiring teacher, a stalwart, and the most admired and respected for the outstanding contribution at the Indian and the international horizon, Dr. Suchitra Pandit Ma'am. She is the consultant, Department of Obstetrics, Surya Group of Hospitals, Mumbai, the chairperson AICC RCOG, which was a superb tenure. She was the president of ISOPAB, organization Gestosis, the president Foxy and ICOG and MOX. Foxy representative to AOFOG 2015-17, the chair of CEFOG Medical Education Committee 17-18, and she's around from the 8 GCPR guidelines in 2014, the secretary Foxy UNICEF Sayan Kishori Adolescent Empowerment Project for 8 years for making unprivileged girls from Dharavi self-reliant. Lot of 125 publications, authored 5 books, and also awarded 35 orations, several prizes, winner of Lot of Planets Award, FIGO Women's Award 2018, MMC Award, MOX Dr. Desai Award for Excellence, Foxy Dr. Durusha Award, and lots to her credit. Ma'am, you're really an icon of women empowerment, and we request you to give us your pearls of blessings.
Thank you so much, Ritu. And I'd really like to congratulate Dr. Ramani Devi, Vice President of Foxy, because, you know, we've always talked of, Sachin Tendulkar, Sunil Gavaskar, and, you know, Rahul Dravid, where they deliver sixers after sixers and everybody claps for them. And for Ramani Devi, there's one big clap because she's doing this with her committee, with Asha Rao and with all her committee members. She's been doing this wonderful focused work on endometriosis because that is an enigma. And endometriosis, along with adenomyosis, is even a more difficult topic to tackle. So I'm very glad that she's chosen this. And, we've got excellent speakers. We've got Dr. Khemani, we've got Dr. Asha Rao, and we've got our very own Dr. Bhatt, who will be talking about not just, what exactly is the cause, but also how do you manage it medically as well as surgically. And let me tell you, both these are not easy specialties. They are difficult to handle because we know when we deal with patients with adenomyosis, what problems they go through, whether it's for conception or even when they're talking of a normal life, you know, with heavy periods, and how do they exactly manage that? And of course, I'm happy, Dr. Ramani Devi, you've also chosen case-based approach because, you know, when you see a real life case, you have the clinical knowledge. And then when you have the case-based discussion, you know, that gives us a more, you know, clinical for a clinician. I think that is very, very important. So extremely pleased to be the chief guest over here. And I'm going to sit through the sessions. And thank you very much for having me over. And Ritu, keep smiling. Love to see your very, very vivacious smile all the while. And thank you very much. And all the best for today's program.
Thank you so much, madam, for such loving and enlightening words, and that you'll be there in the session will be a real boost for us also, madam. Thank you so much. And now we would like to invite our guest of honor, a very innovative and inspiration, a guide, and a great academic track record. So many publications nationally, internationally, so humble and loving, Dr. Lakshmi Shirakhande. She is the Director, Shirakhande Fertility Center, Nagpur, the Senior Vice President, FOCSI 2012, the Associate Member, RCOG London, Chairman, HIV Committee, FOCSI 2009-12, the Vice Chairperson-elect, ICOG, Editor, FOCSI Focus on HIV and SUI Myths and Facts, publications 30 national, 7 international, received the Best FOCSI Committee Award and the National Editor of the Journal of Obstetrics of India. Ma'am, we await your words of inspiration. You'll have to unmute, madam.
Thank you so much, Ritu, for your kind words. It's a pleasure to share the dais with my friend, philosopher and guide, Dr. Suchitra Pandit. Suchitra, still there is so much to learn from you, and you have done mind-boggling work for ISOPARP and RCOG. And I fully agree with you, Ramani Devi. She has compared it with you, Sunil Gavaskar. I will compare you with Virat Kohli. We live in the 21st century. I mean, really, your focused work along with Asha towards endometriosis is really commendable. And the choice of topics from adolescent to perimenopause is also very good. And selection of faculty, right, from youngsters to experienced ones. So, mix tadka hai aaj ke program mein. Young or experienced ka, that is also a very good thing in your program. And as far as perimenopause is concerned, FOCSI ka nara hai, save the uterus. So, I'm very happy you are discussing perimenopause and adenomyosis, because most of the times, whenever the gynecologist sees adenomyosis, patient comes with heavy menstrual bleeding, they just don't use their brain to investigate and medically manage. They just opt and give the option of hysterectomy. So I'm very happy that you are covering the perimenopause and adenomyosis, and the speakers will be giving the delegates, they will be enlightening about the options of evaluations and the options for treatment. And fertility, so I know. I run my IVF center. It's really a big challenge when a patient comes with a big adenomyosis and she wants a baby. So you are covering all the three aspects in a woman's life: adolescent, reproduction, and perimenopause. So all the very best, Ritu, Ramani, for this wonderful focused webinar on adenomyosis. So I am also waiting with Suchitra for this focused webinar. So without much delay, let us go ahead with the scientific sessions.
One second. Ritu, I should thank Dr. Suchitra and Dr. Lakshmi Shrikante for such an excellent words. I am really humbled, madam. But why we chose adenomyosis was, every time we have been talking about endometriosis, and in the last EndometCon conference, some doctors were asking that we want to have an exclusive topic on adenomyosis, because we find adenomyosis is no more a disease of the third decade. Even the youngsters, even 18, 20-year-old, and we see huge adenomyosis in reproductive age group. So I thought this would be an excellent choice for this today's program. And I also thank Dr. Ritu Khanna for having coordinated everybody. And I think I would always love to have youngsters in my team. because they are going to be our future future generation, future stars of India. So I welcome each and every person who are going going to participate in this and enlighten the people who are attending this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Ramani ma'am, Suchitra ma'am, and Lakshmi ma'am for such loving words. And now to start with the scientific, I would like to call upon the chairpersons. And the first chairperson whom I'm going to call is a very, very passionate personality and a teacher par excellence, no other than Dr. Ramani Devi ma'am. She's the managing director of Ramakrishna Medical Center.
Rito, you can skip this. Just a vice president, Foxy, and interested in endometriosis. That's all.
And the second chairperson next we have is Dr. Archana Verma, a very versatile, innovative, determined, and always smiling personality. And she is the vice president-elect, Foxy, and also the past president and secretary of GOGS.
But as Dr. Ramani said, vice president-elect is enough awareness.
So welcome to you, Archana, ma'am. And next we have Dr. Sneha Bhuyar, who's such a charming and pious personality we have on the dais, and she is the chairperson study on female breast committee, Foxy, 1921. And she just got into the governing council member, ICOG, 1921. And also she has the national award of Foxy for outstanding work in rural obstetrics, Dr. Anandibai Joshi Award.
Thank you. You may skip the introduction of my as well. We can go ahead with the scientific session.
Thank you, ma'am. And Dr. Kalyan Bamade, who's talented and full of zeal and enthusiasm, and he's been elected the treasurer of IAGE. Congratulations to you, Dr. Kalyan.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
And he's also got a lot of awards, and he's been an operating faculty and a guest speaker in national, international, and published papers also. And so now we start with this session, and I request Dr. Ramani Devi, ma'am, to introduce Dr. Manju Khemani.
Dr. Manju Khemani is a director from the Department of OBGYN, Max Smart Super Speciality Hospital in New Delhi. Probably the first time I met Manju Khemani was in a Bayer's meeting on endometriosis international program.
Yes, ma'am.
Was the first time we met. I enjoyed the company of Dr. Manju, who is so much interested more towards endometriosis. And she has been the chairperson of Endometriosis Committee of AOGV, and past chairperson of Safe Motherhood Committee, fellowship in Advanced Gynecological Endoscopy, done at Mumbai Endoscopy Academy and Center for Minimal Invasive Surgery, Mumbai, past president of DGFS, peer reviewer of Editor Jogi, and recipient of Abdul Kalam Award. And she has a rich experience in this particular field, and she will be the apt person to deliver her talk on pathogenesis of adenomyosis. Welcome, Dr. Manju.
Good evening, everybody. At the outset, let me thank Dr. Ramani Devi, Dr. Ritu Khanna, and Dr. Asha Rao for giving me this opportunity. Let me just start sharing my screen. Is my screen visible to you all?
No, madam, not yet.
Not yet. Okay. How do I do it? Tell me.
Madam, if you could just press the green button on the Zoom window.
Yeah, I've done that, you know.
And then I think you need to open the PPT at the background first.
Screen.
Okay.
And then share. Press the share button, blue color button at the bottom.
So if I'm sharing my PPT, it is the blue button is disappearing. Okay, just give me a second. Is my PPT visible now?
Madam, you can see the internet window at this point. If you could just open the PPT. It's currently minimized on your system.
Can you see it now?
Yes, ma'am. Now we can.
So I'll just zoom it. Just give me a second. Is that visible now? Okay, right. So, after the, I'm the first batsman of this inning, and I'm going to speak on etiopathogenesis of adenomyosis and infertility. When I started reading it, I thought it's a very boring topic. Let me see how I can, you know, make it interesting for everybody. just to recapitulate, you know, adenomyosis is regarded as a disease of endomyometrium junction, right? It is defined, there are two factors to it. One, the endometrial glands, they invaginate through the endomyometrial junction, right? So there are heterotopic endometrial glands in the myometrium. And the second component is that myometrium undergoes hypertrophy, hyperplasia, and there's a fibrosis, right? So adenomyosis, classically, it was diagnosed, you know, in the fourth or fifth decade of life. And patients usually used to come with the progressively increasing dysmenorrhea and menorrhagia, and they were offered hysterectomy. Now, infertility is a less frequent complaint in classical form, but as more and more women, they started delaying pregnancy until 30th or 40th, you know, their years of life, the relationship between adenomyosis and infertility, it is becoming more relevant. We all know that, you know, 30% of adenomyosis patients, they are asymptomatic, and we are not going to talk about them. 20% of cases, they involve women who are younger than 40 years of age. These are the women we are going to concentrate. So classically, you know, when I was a PG, diagnosis of adenomyosis was made by histopathology, and there was so much of dispute among even among the pathologists. But with the increasing resolution of transvaginal ultrasound, 3D ultrasound, and magnetic resonant imaging, it has made possible to diagnose adenomyosis without histopathology, because these things, they clearly display endomyometrial junction. This is a transvaginal image, and as you can see, this is myometrium, this is endometrium. Myometrium and endometrium, they are opposed. There is nothing, no layer in between. And this, you know, hypoechoic area is the main thing, you know, which if it is disturbed, there is adenomyosis, there is infertility. So before I come to my topic, how are we diagnosing adenomyosis these days, right? So there are no clear-cut guidelines, accepted guidelines in this. And any patient where you're suspecting clinically that patient has adenomyosis, TVS is advised. And how do you diagnose adenomyosis on transvaginal sonography? So because the endometrium has invaginated inside the muscle, so when you see in the TVS, there's a heterogeneous, hypoechogenic, poorly described area in the myometrium. There may be lacunes, there may be linear striations, there's a poor definition of junctional zone, and there's a thickening of the posterior wall of the myometrium. Plus, there is a pseudo-widening of endometrium. So, if any of these three things are present in the TVS, then we say the patient has adenomyosis. Diagnosis of adenomyosis also can be reliably made with the 3D transvaginal sonography. How? If the junctional zone measures more than 8 millimeters, if there is a myometrial asymmetry, or if there are hypoechoic striations. So if out of all these three, if there are two are present, then we are 90% accurate that this lady has adenomyosis. MRI is superior to TVS to exclude diagnosis of adenomyosis. It has an equal sensitivity, but it has a higher specificity. And we suspect adenomyosis if the junctional zone thickness is greater than 12 millimeter. Though in 20% cases, you will not be able to see the junctional zone at all in the premenopausal women. So, 2004, this paper was published in Fertility Sterility Journal. And, you know, they had said that, you know, those baboons who are affected by lifelong infertility, they have lifelong primary infertility. Those baboons who have adenomyosis, they have lifelong primary infertility. And after that, many papers came, you know, prospective study, retrospective study, and all these studies were from the IVF center. Where what they had done, they had compared the outcome in a woman who had adenomyosis vis-a-vis a woman who has a normal uterus. So in 2014, this Varsalini et al., they did a meta-analysis. And what did they find? They found that, you know, there were five studies which said that, you know, yes, clinical pregnancy rate is less in an IVF patient but if she has adenomyosis. And two studies said that no, the clinical pregnancy rate is not less. Another important factor which came out through this meta-analysis was that, you know, miscarriage rate is more in those patients, first trimester miscarriage, in those patients who have adenomyosis. And this diamond shows that overall the adenomyotic patient, miscarriage rate is more. And their conclusion was that, you know, adenomyosis, it impacts IVF and ICSI negatively because it is associated with 28% reduction of clinical pregnancy and more than double that of miscarriage. And they also suggested that a patient who is going for IVF, TVS should be done to rule out the adenomyosis. But in all these studies, there were a lot of heterogeneity because somebody has taken some factors for to diagnose adenomyosis, other person has taken other thing. So that's why this study does not have that much value as any meta-analysis of RCTs would have had. So now coming to my topic, if we have to understand why adenomyotic woman has infertility, let's just see what is the pathogenesis of adenomyosis. So we all know that, you know, endometrium layer, it invaginates through the absent junctional zone. This was the first time defined by the Bergeron et al. So estradiol expression in adenomyotic focus, it is increased. Not only this, there is a apoptosis suppressing gene product. Right, apoptosis is a normal thing. Any tissue will die, and again it will regenerate. You know, so apoptotic suppressing gene product also is increased. So because of estradiol receptor increased, and because of BCL2 gene, there is a hyperestrogenic state, and this process continues, and patient then has adenomyosis. This was the theory of Bergeron et al. Another theory of Lekendron et al. You know, they said the main mechanism is TR. What is TR? Tissue injury and repair. Let me just explain it to you. So there is a local hypoestrogenism. That means inside the uterus, estrogen is more, though in the periphery it is normal, which leads to increased uterine peristaltic activity, which in turn leads to mechanical strain and pseudoconal rafting. Tears, right? Because once these tears happen because of this mechanical strain, TR is started. What is TR? Tissue injury and repair. So more estrogen is produced because whenever there is an injury inside the uterus, estrogen is required to heal it. Once more estrogen is produced inside the uterus, then interleukin 1 factor, which is a part of TR, it comes into place. And this TR, then, you know, this interleukin 1 starts, you know, producing, works on the COX-2 enzyme, and more of PGE2 starts producing. This PGE2 in turn, you know, stimulates cytochrome P450 enzyme. That means TAR is, you know, initiated, and this cytochrome P450, we all know, it converts testosterone into estrogen, so more hyperestrogenism, more peristalsis, and chronic inflammation, and that's how adenomyosis develops. Okay, so so if we have to understand the etiopathology of infertility, so now let's see the what are the differences in a uterus where there is adenomyosis and in a uterus which is absolutely normal. So let's start with the first fact. What about first? Let's see the hormonal alteration. So this disease we know is primarily characterized by the hyperestrogenism. That means these patients who have adenomyosis, in their menstrual blood, you will see more estrogen is there. Though peripheral estrogen is normal, they have increased PGE2. Because there is an increased hyperestrogenism, there is a downregulation of progesterone, loss of direction, and finally a progesterone resistant develops, right? So that is the hormonal alteration in adenomyotic uteri. What about the immunological alteration? Now, this hyperestrogenism stimulates production of interleukin 10. See, in the muscle, you know, endometrium is invaginating. So endometrium is foreign. So ideally, body should recognize and kill it. Why it doesn't kill it? Because interleukin 10 causes immunosuppression. So body is not able to recognize these endometriotic cells. Not only this, there is increased number of macrophages. So we have seen hormonal differences between adenomyotic uterus and normal. We have seen the immunological differences. And third is the abnormal inflammatory responses. So there is altered secretion of interleukin 6 and 8. Now, because there is an overexpression of interleukin 6, which contributes to local hyperestrogenism and defect in the progesterone, plus there is a reduction in B3 integrin. We all know B3 integrin starts the talk between an embryo and the endometrium. So hence, the uterine receptivity in adenomyosis is decreased. IL-6 is also an implantation marker. Inside the uterus, the free radicals have to be less. If they are more, the sperm transport will not happen, implantation will not happen, pregnancy will not happen. So low concentration of free radicals, they are necessary to create an appropriate environment. But in an adenomyotic uterus, these free radicals are more. This slide, I'm just explaining, but its final explanation will be later on. So we all know that the oxygen tension is in low in the fallopian tube, which is 60 millimeter. It is even lower in the uterus, 30 millimeter, as compared to atmosphere where it is 150 millimeter. Because embryo can physiologically grow in a low, reduced oxygen atmosphere. Now, nitric oxide is a highly reactive free radical, right? Oxygen free radicals, they cause embryonic arrest and they embryo will not be able to grow. So in adenomyotic uterus, we have seen all these three abnormal parameters. Now, what about hypervascularization? Now, vascular distribution of endometrium in adenomyosis has shown to be different from a endometrium of a fertile patient. Hysteroscopy reveals that these women, they have vascular distribution, distribution is generally irregular and these vessels are thick. In a normal fertile woman, morphometric analysis of endometrium reveals that in a fertile woman, the mean surface area, total surface area and total number of capillaries, they are all increased significantly in secretory phase as compared to in the proliferative phase. But in adenomyosis, all these factors are same in both, whether it is in proliferative or whether it is in a secretory phase, because vascular proliferation is diversely exaggerated. And this hypervascularization is because of the hyperestrogenism. Not only this, there is increased greater activity of VEGF. So this determines that an abnormal development both in proliferative as well as in the secretory phase. Now, this is a normal hysteroscopic picture of a proliferative phase, secretory phase, and what happens in adenomyosis. As you can see, these vessel walls are, you know, irregular, thick. There is this, you know, collection, you know, if you just poke it, the blood will come out. Another picture where the vessels are really thick and irregular, irregular endometrium, and again a this thing collection there. And if you are doing a hysteroscopy, you must poke it so that the blood is drained out, it will do good to the patient. So now we have seen the difference between adenomyotic uterus and a normal uterus. Now we can discuss, you know, what are the mechanism of infertility in a patient who has adenomyosis. First, there is an abnormal uterotubule transport. Obviously, adenoma is there, it is distorting the uterine cavity, and it may obstruct tubal ostia and interfere with the sperm migration. Then there is a disturbed uterine peristalsis and sperm transport, because the peristalsis, they originate solely from the junctional zone. Outer myometrium is absolutely quiet. What happens in the adenomyosis? This junctional zone is destroyed because of the invagination of the endometrium gland. And there is a hyperplastic muscles. So there is a dysfunctional uterine hyperperistalsis with increased intrauterine pressure. Not only this, if you take the ultrastructure of, you know, adenomyotic muscles, what one will find that these myocytes, they have nuclear hypertrophy, abnormal nucleus, mitochondrial shape, and all this causes loss of normal rhythmic contraction, eventually affecting the uterotubal transfer. So that's the one factor causing infertility. Second factor is the endometrial function and receptivity, both are altered. How? So Kitabaki et al., they demonstrated that, you know, in those patients who have adenomyosis, in the adenomyotic foci as well as in their endometrium, both they have excessive aromatase cytochrome P450 protein and mRNA. And in a patient where cytochrome P450 aromatase is more, in there is pregnancy cannot happen. And what we have seen that when you give them GnRH agonist, prednisone, it decreases expression of P450 aromatase and the eutrophic endometrium of adenomyosis. And that's why when a patient of adenomyosis is given 4-5 months of GnRH analog, they conceive. Third factor which causes infertility is abnormal inflammatory strong response. Tremlin et al., they reported that women who have severe adenomyosis and who do not conceive, who have failed implantation, they have significantly greater stromal macrophages density as compared to non-adenomyotic control. And these macrophages, they have a capacity to produce TNF-alpha, interleukin-1, and they also produce a reactive oxygen that can be toxic to the embryo. Interleukin-6 and interleukin-10 also is increased in the adenomyosis. We have already seen it. So there's an abnormal inflammatory response. This impairs the fertility. Lastly, altered expression of estrogen and progesterone receptor is there. We have seen because interleukin 6 is increased, so there are increased estrogen receptors. Because increased estrogen receptors are there, progesterone receptors are decreased throughout the adenomyotic, in the muscles, everywhere. This because the progesterone receptors are decreased, so there's an overexpression of the ER alpha and plus beta 3 integrin, which is a this thing, you know, which makes a talk between the embryo and the lining, that also is decreased. So that's why the uterine receptivity is decreased. Plus, in a fertile patient, normal woman, concentration of nitric oxide synthetase, superoxide dismutase, they are low during proliferative phase and they increase during the early and mid secretory phase. But in adenomyosis, levels do not fluctuate. All these enzymes, they are overexpressed, and the abnormal level of these enzymes causes havoc inside the uterine cavity and free radicals are more. And as a result, it damages the fertilized egg. And lastly, so we have seen integrin, the leukemic inhibitory factor. It is an essential cytokine for successful egg implantation during human reproduction. And this leukemic inhibitory factor, it is lower in the endometrium in women who have adenomyosis in the mid-secretory phase. So integrin B3 is decreased, leukemic inhibitory factor is decreased, and HOXA10 gene, which helps in the embryonic development, this also is altered. So because of all these things, there is an impaired implantation. So take-home message is that adenomyosis decreases pregnancy rate and increases first trimester miscarriage rate. Before ART, it is necessary to diagnose adenomyosis and put patient on long-term GnRH agonist before FET to improve pregnancy. But we should take it with a pinch of salt because there are so many adenomyotic patients who conceive. Why? Because there is a heterogeneity in the study, because we still do not have the guidelines. Okay, these findings means 100% confirmed adenomyosis. So more work has to be done on that area. Thank you very much for your patience here.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for this such comprehensive and precise presentation. I think through this difficult etiopathogenesis. And now I request Dr. Kalyan to give his expert opinion on the same.
Dr. Manju has given such a good overview about the etiopathology of adenomyosis and infertility. As everybody knows, she has touched all the points. We were basically knowing only 3 points: abnormal uterotubule transport, endometrial receptivity, and impaired implantation. But she has gone beyond all these points to histological points and all smaller points she has covered. There is one study we need to do about the peritoneal fluid in TNF-alpha and prostaglandins, which is increased in endometriosis. But it is found that this is not increased in case of adenomyosis. So I think for everybody to think that these studies, because as such adenomyosis and infertility is having a really worst outcome in case of infertility and IVF, we need to do more studies about these TNF-alpha and peritoneal fluids for adenomyosis and how we can increase the success rate. Really, thank you, Dr. Manju ma'am, for such an exhaustive and good lecture. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Kalyan. I would like to have Dr. Archana Verma madam here to give us her views. Dr. Archana Verma madam is here.
As you're waiting for Archana, let me congratulate Dr. Manju for having given such a wonderful deliberation. Manju, I really enjoyed that talk. So many points have been cleared by you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Asha. Thank you.
Yeah. So thank you so much. And we move into the next presentation. And if Dr. Archana Verma is there, she could join us to introduce. Dr. Archana Verma, madam, are you there? Okay. I would request Dr. Sneha, ma'am, to please introduce Dr. Asha Rao, ma'am.
Yes, thank you, Ritu, and good evening, everyone. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Ramani Devi and Dr. Asha Rao for inviting us here and making us part of this program. Of course, Dr. Asha has a very focused work and a very dynamic chairperson of Endometriosis Committee, FOCSI, and a very good friend of ours. She has an experience of 25 years in ART. She's the director of Rao Hospital and Care Coimbatore. She's the director of postdoctoral fellowship program in reproductive medicine and endogynecology and is affiliated to Tamil Nadu Dr. MGR Medical University, Chennai. She's a past president of...
That's good enough, I think, Sneha.
Yeah.
The stage. Next time onwards, we're going to write only 4 sentences for all of us. Thank you so much, Sneha.
Thank you. My pleasure, dear.
Yeah. And at the outset, let me thank Dr. Ramani Devi, the fantastic brain behind the show, and our smart, young, dynamic Ritu Khanna, the convener, for having invited me here to speak on. To speak on my passionate subject, that is adenomyosis. I think it's in year 1992 that I came across this lady who was 34 years and married for 16 years. And she had dysmenorrhea and infertility of 16 years. And she had a globular uterus of 12 weeks size. And on histolaparoscopy, we saw that she had a tubal block, which could not be actually released by tubal cannulation. Tubal cannulation was primitive those days. No, we had just started the tubal cannulation in 1992. And those days we only had danazol. And when we gave danazol to this lady for 6 months and we stopped, she had a spontaneous conception. And the girl who was born in 1993 got married last year. And it was such a happy occasion for us. This is how my journey into adenomyosis began in 1992, I would say. And the disease, which is more than 150 years old, adenomyosis, continues to be enigmatic, elusive, and challenging, and haunts women with severe dysmenorrhea and menorrhagia. And today, my talk is adenomyosis and infertility, non-surgical management. So all of us know that dysmenorrhea and menorrhagia are the hallmarks of the disease, along with pelvic pain. And dyspareunia can also be there in 15 to 30% of patients. And today, infertility and pregnancy loss have also been considered as symptoms of adenomyosis. And the change in trend is alarming. The disease is no longer considered typical of women who are Paris, multiparity, cesarean sections, curettage, myomectomy, etc. used to be the predisposing factors for adenomyosis. Today we know that it is a disease which is, you know, Manju has told us so beautifully about the etiopathogenesis. And we know that it affects younger women today and also younger infertile women. According to Chaperon, almost 30% of young women are affected by adenomyosis. It is also seen in 20% of infertile women less than 40 years undergoing assisted reproductive technology. And there are so many recent RCT which have shown us that adenomyosis is associated with infertility. There is lower rate of successful implantation and increased risk of pregnancy loss and overall reduction in live birth rate. And this has been described in detail in this wonderful paper by Tulani and Yoon's Infertility Sterility in 2017. And this is another paper by Salim et al., which shows that with adenomyosis, the pregnancy rate is 22%, and in non-adenomyotic women, it is 47% in women undergoing IVF. And even the ongoing pregnancy rates were quite low, 11% with adenomyosis and 45% without adenomyosis. This is 2012. And there are so many studies which have shown that there is an association between adenomyosis and miscarriage. Miscarriage rate was 32% in women with adenomyosis and 14% in women without adenomyosis undergoing IVF ICSI, which is a very, very significant association. And as all of us know, the adenomyosis can be focal or diffuse and happens when there is a damage to the junctional zone. The junctional zone is not more than, here you can see the endometrium, the myometrium, and the subendometrial halo. So this is the area of junctional zone, which is barely 4 to 5 millimeters in women of reproductive age group. And when it's more than 8 millimeters, you can suspect adenomyosis. And when it is more than 10 millimeters, you can diagnose adenomyosis. And the disease, which was historically diagnosed by histopathology at hysterectomy, today is seen in younger women. And I think it's the diagnostic modalities like ultrasound, which have really come to a diagnose adenomyosis at an early stage. MRI is said to be the gold standard, but adenomyosis, which is available to all of us in the infertility clinics, has really made a tremendous difference in the outlook of we the gynecologists. With 2D ultrasound, you can diagnose it with about 70 to 80% accuracy. But if you, like this, you can diagnose the big adenomyoma, but you need to diagnose it in early stage with the help of 3D. Here you can see the endometrium, the myometrium, the junctional zone, and the early infiltration of adenomyosis. And this is focal adenomyosis. Most of us have a good ultrasound machine, and kindly buy a machine with 3D attachment so that you can diagnose adenomyosis at an early stage and see that prevent these women from having either recurrent implantation failure or a recurrent miscarriage, which is very, very important. And today my work is less. I need not talk about the pathogenesis, which has been made very clear by Dr. Manju already, and the changes in the implantation markers. So there are changes in the, not only the adenomyotic lesion, there are changes in utopic endometrium also. The factors favoring implantation are reduced. The factors which are averse to implantation are increased. There is increase in the macrophage and natural killer cells in the endometrium, increase in the ROS. And very important is there is also change in the muscle layer from slight localized expansion of the junctional zone to massive myometrial hyperplasia and fibrosis. And this absolutely changes the tonus and plasticity of the uterus and also the contour of the endometrial cavity. And the hyperperistaltic uterine contractions play a very significant role, and it can interfere with gamete transport, fertilization, and also implantation. This is a wonderful paper by Hashimoto et al. In 2018. So adenomyosis, which causes chronic inflammation-like changes in the uterus, also causes impaired uteroplacental perfusion, leading to decrease in implantation and problems of miscarriage, preeclampsia, small for date babies, preterm deliveries, placental malposition, etc., etc. So many reproductive dysfunctions could happen because of adenomyosis. So thus the need for early diagnosis and management. And there are wonderful papers from, say, 2006 onwards, Juang, Machimoro, Hashimoto, Shin, Tamura, Yamaguchi. I think most of the papers are from Japan. So I can see from 2006 to 2019, there have been so many papers, and each of them stressing upon the various reproductive dysfunction that you have already described. And these are caused by adenomyosis. So when these women come to your doorstep seeking fertility, how do you manage them? How do you help them? You can help them with conservative surgery, medical management, or ART. You can do it alone, each one separately, or in combination. So far, we have limited data available regarding the efficacy of different treatment modalities for adenomyosis, and you have to decide depending on the age of the woman, desire for fertility, and type of lesion. I think the utmost is fertility conservation. That is the topic of the day, and I would definitely opt for medical management. And sometimes we can be helped by non-surgical interventions like HIFU and uterine artery embolization. And surgical management, I would keep as a last resort. NSAID are of help to us to manage the dysmenorrhea, but they do not really help us in regressing the lesion. OCP can help us to some extent in controlling the menorrhagia and dysmenorrhea. I think I would prescribe them to women who are PARES and who still continue to have dysmenorrhea and menorrhagia. They can be helped by the oral contraceptive pills because there is less of volume reduction or healing of the lesions by OCP. Whereas danazol, I told you already, I had wonderful experience in those years around the age of 1990s with danazol. We have used, all of us, I'm sure the seniors have used tons and tons of danazol. And this wonderful drug lost its popularity because of the severe androgenic effects like hoarseness of voice and changes in the breast, skin changes. These were also not reversible. So such a wonderful drug has lost its popularity. Today, our friend in the infertility clinic would be GnRH analog, dinogest, aromatase inhibitors, intrauterine system with progestogen, and of course, ART. As Dr. Manju already described, GnRH analogs cause decrease in the expression of aromatase cytochrome P450 in the utopic endometrium of women with adenomyosis and also in the adenomyotic lesion, and also decreases the expression of nitric oxide synthesis. So it acts at the root cause. So it promotes good healing of the regression of the lesions of adenomyosis. It is anti-estrogenic and causes apoptosis, and it also has anti-inflammatory properties. So pre-IVF JNR channel locks for 3 to 6 cycles optimize ART outcome. New et al. Found that a long course of down regulation significantly improves the clinical pregnancy rate, ongoing pregnancy rate, and implantation rate in patients with adenomyosis, also proven by Tulandi et al. In 2018. And if you give JNRH analogs for 2 to 6 months, there is a wonderful reduction of uterine volume from 180 ml to 80 ml. And another paper by Holmes et al. From Netherlands, which says that adenomyosis has no adverse effects on IVF ICSI in women with endometriosis and adenomyosis, provided you use long-term pituitary down regulation. And there are also some other wonderful papers which have studied egg donation with endometriosis and adenomyosis. If you use pre-IVF JNRH suppression, the implantation rates are equal in women with and without adenomyosis. Some more papers by New et al. Here you can see in women without JNRH analog, the implantation rate is 16%. And with JNRH suppression, it jumped to 32%. Pregnancy rate, once again, 24% without JNRH analog and 51% with JNRH analog. Ongoing pregnancy rates also have doubled with JNRH analog suppression prior to embryo transfer. Maybe the usage of hormones would be slightly longer by 2 days and the dosage may be slightly altered, but the success rate is definitely remarkable. This is one of the patients with 2 IVF failures elsewhere. And when she came to us, we realized that she had adenomyosis, which was not recognized earlier. So she was given a long JNRH analog for 12 weeks. After 6 weeks, the suppression was minimal. But after 12 weeks, you can see the suppression was almost complete. And endometrium is beautifully expanded. And after 4 weeks, that is 16 weeks after the JNRH depot, when we did the embryo transfer, this lady conceived twins. And it was wonderful carrying those twin babies in our arms. This is another patient who had previous 2 laparoscopies, 1 IVF failure, came to us and we saw she had a posterior wall adenomyosis, which was almost 5 to 6 centimeter. And she also had small chocolate cysts. She also had DIE and severe dysmenorrhea. We suppressed this lady for 12 to 16 weeks with JNRH depot. And with the ultra-long protocol, we did a JNRH, we did a egg collection and we did a fresh transfer and she conceived. But today, more and more, you would prefer to do a egg collection first, make embryos, vitrify them, and then later suppress the adenomyosis, depending on the size of the adenomyoma, and then do a frozen thawed embryo transfer, which seems to be more logical. The rate of euploid miscarriage seems to be increased in the setting of adenomyosis, and this can be reversed if you use pre-IVF JNRH analogs in the wonderful papers by Tremelin et al. And it also seems to improve the post-implantation pregnancy health. That means it prevents the problems of IUGR, preterm labor, etc. So JNRH analogs have been really our friend for more than 15 years in my fertility clinic. And today we have Dynogest, which is the wonder molecule of the decade, which is a derivative of 19-nor testosterone. And it is a progestin actually. Once again, it has anti-estrogenic, gestogenic properties and promotes apoptosis. It has got immunomodulatory properties. It is very good for the dysmenorrhea, dyspareunia, chronic pelvic pain associated with adenomyosis, just like JNRH analog. But JNRH analog seem to be superior to Dynogest in controlling menorrhagia and for reduction of uterine volume. If you ask me which is the best drug for a sure control, I would definitely say it is JNRH analog. And because of the expense and the fear of bone loss, you can always start with JNRH analog first, and after 3 cycles, perhaps you can switch over to Dynogest. Or you can even insert an intrauterine LNG system. And this is a wonderful study where the actions of JNRH analog, low-dose estrogen progesterone, and Dynogest have been compared by Matushima et al. In 2018. The medications were given for 16 weeks. Here you can see the very impressive volume reduction from JNRH analog from 307 ml to 177 ml. Whereas with the low-dose estrogen progesterone or dynoges, there was no change at all. Some papers have claimed reduction in volume by dynoges, but it is slow and it takes a long time. It is not as remarkable as the action of GnRH analog. And a wonderful medication which is not so known is aromatase inhibitor. You can use aromatase inhibitors like letrozole 2.5 milligram per day for 8 to 12 weeks. There is once again a very impressive reduction in the volume of adenomyoma. There is a reduction of the adenomyosis symptoms, and there can also be a very good reduction of uterine volume. A combination of aromatase inhibitors and GnRH analog give a reduction in uterine volume by 60% in the papers by Tamura et al. Once again, the aromatase inhibitors cause profound hypoestrogenism, just like GnRH analogs. So you need to give a progesterone add back. Otherwise, it can also cause follicular cysts. So kindly use progesterone add back whenever you use aromatase inhibitors or GnRH analog. A combination of aromatase inhibitors plus GnRH analog seem to give a pregnancy rate of 48%, whereas with the dynoges, the pregnancy rate was only 20%. So the combination seemed to be better to that of dynoges. So do not say that I am biased about GnRH analogs. There are so many papers which have proven that this drug is superior to dynoges. And our dear friend LNG-IUD, which we have been using for over 15 years, can be used in conjunction with other treatment modalities such as GnRH analog and aromatase inhibitors. Because whenever you are causing hypoestrogenism, it is, I think, quite logical to use a progesterone add back into the uterus directly rather than giving it orally. So it causes local decidualization, reduces the local prostaglandins. So women have very definite relief from menorrhagia, dysmenorrhea, and there is also optimization of pregnancy rates. This once again, another paper, LNG-IUS group had a implantation rate of 32% compared to 22% in the controls. So once again, it is logical to use GnRH analog or aromatase inhibitors. Sometimes we have used them together also, plus the LNG-IUD. So you're not worried about the bone loss anymore. Our dear friend of SAS, danazole, is coming back in the form of intrauterine device or vaginal rings. 400 milligram of danazole in the form of intrauterine device can last for 6 months, reduces dysmenorrhea, dyspareunia, pelvic pain, very minimal androgenic side effects, and good pregnancy rates have been described. Uterine artery embolization, I would say, is more for Paris women with dysmenorrhea. And in women desires of fertility, sometimes increased complications like ovarian failure, amenorrhea, fistula formation were seen. But today, once again, there is a resurgence of interest in uterine artery embolization. Maybe in a few years, we will have more papers analyzing whether it is good or bad for women desires of fertility. So who will benefit from uterus sparing surgery adenomyosis? A well-defined adenomyoma of more than 5 cm, recurrent miscarriage, or recurrent implantation failure after IVF, provided there is no response to medication. So kindly use medical management. If this phase, that's the only time you have to use surgery, because with surgery, we know that the disease is not removed completely. Recurrence is common. And as per this fantastic paper by Tan et al. In 2018, the reproductive outcomes appear to be better in the focal adenomyosis group rather than diffuse after surgery. But the high incidence of 6.8% uterine rupture is what we are all worried about. After a myomectomy or cesarean section, the uterine rupture chances are barely 0.5 to 1%. So 6.8% is such a high rate of uterine rupture. And uterine ruptures have been described, sometimes you may think of this as preterm contraction. A lady in Japan had a uterine rupture while she was receiving Ritodrin for preterm labor. And at 32 weeks, luckily they could rush ahead and do a laparotomy and save the babies. And this kind of reports have been described from all over the world. So kindly think of ruptured uterus before you enthusiastically do a laparoscopic adenomyomectomy on these women. According to Osada et al., focal adenomyosis, it's okay to do laparoscopic surgery. However, for diffuse type of lesions, they require extensive resection, complicated suturing. You should not have any dead space. So he prefers the use of his triple flap technique and laparotomy. So in summary, if a woman with adenomyosis comes to your doorstep, do a routine infertility workup, including measurement of ovarian function and semen analysis. Maybe even you do IUI if the lesion is small, like anybody else. If required, you can use a long protocol GnRH agonist suppression and allow natural conception. But if there's a male factor or tubal problem, you may need to go in for urgent IVF. So if there is a failure after a couple of cycles of pre-IVF GnRH suppression, that's the only time you may go in for a surgery. So allow natural conception if possible. If not possible, do a GnRH suppression and do IVF a couple of times. And if it is impossible, that's the only time you go in for a surgery. Because chances of ruptured uterus are totally avoided whenever you do a medical management. This is our own series of adenomyosis and ART at Rao Hospital, where we had more of medical management, and pregnancy rate for 44%, miscarriage rate was 32%, just like the previous series, and live birth rate of 68% was quite impressive. These are the last two or three of my slides. This is a lady who was married 15 years, 39 years. She already had an adenomyomectomy elsewhere, failed IVF elsewhere. When she came to us, we saw this huge adenomyosis, 6 centimeters in the posterior wall. There was no way we could do another adenomyomectomy. So this lady was suppressed by 2 doses of GnRH analog for 6 months, along with progesterone add-back. And because of her age of 39 years and previous surgery for endometriosis, she underwent egg donation. We transferred 2 embryos. She conceived triplets, which became twins at 7 weeks. And she had a live birth at 36 weeks with good-sized babies, no IUGR. And this was in 2006. And these babies today are more than, 14 years. This is another lady, 39 years, with secondary infertility of 8 years. She had a history of laparotomy twice, laparoscopy thrice elsewhere. She had severe dysmenorrhea, thick endometrium. And ultrasound showed diffuse adenomyosis with endometriosis. Previous 5 IVF failures. She already had 2 cycles of egg donation also. So initially we gave a dynogest. I said, why not try dynogest? We gave a dynogest for 10 weeks, but I did not see that much regression. Because of endometrial hyperplasia, she also had a Mirena for 13 weeks. And at the end of it, she had IVF with egg donation, no pregnancy. And later I had to go back to my dear friend GnRH depot, 11.2. And we waited for 3 months. And now the embryo transfer, she has conceived. And this happens to be her 7th IVF and 2nd IVF with us. And now she's a happy mother of a 6-month-old girl baby. So to summarize, pre-treatment with GnRH analog appears to be beneficial in the management of adenomyosis. It definitely improves the fertility outcomes and reduces the complications of reproductive dysfunction. The benefits on fertility-preserving surgery vary greatly and require some more RCTs before we think of surgery as the first resort. So thank you all for a patient hearing. If there are any questions, you can post it in the chat box. Thank you, Dr. Ramani Devi, once again for having given me this opportunity.
Wonderful deliberation, Dr. Asha, and a very clear-cut take-home message is there. I think we need not be multiparous and elderly for having adenomyosis. We should have the high index of suspicion. Yeah, even the younger girls and the women of reproductive age group, they are having or suffering from adenomyosis. Very true as far as the symptomatic relief is concerned. The dynogest and GnRH analogs are comparable as far as the pregnancy is concerned, because GnRH analogs, they are having the inhibitory effect on the P450 and the nitrous oxide synthetase. Definitely, as far as the pregnancy is concerned, may it be spontaneous or even after ART procedures, GnRH analogs are better. And when we want to use it for long term, to avoid the bone loss, we can put the patient on GnRH analogs for first 3 months, and then we can shift to dynogest. Very well taken there. Thank you so much, Dr. Asha.
Thank you.
Asha explained the presentation, and you know, your results were also wonderful. I just like to mention here that, you know, seven. I just come back from UK and we used to talk about endometriosis and, you know, PCOS, and everybody would say, oh, these are the diseases of the West. That year, I also attended the Copenhagen conference, and Yamamoto had got the first prize in poster presentation, and it was basically on endometriosis. So we went to ask him, you know, you're talking so much about endometriosis and about P45 and cytochrome and whatnot, you know, which was going over our heads. So he said, no, this is the disease of the future. Everybody in Asia will have this problem. And, you know, what he was trying to say is, you know, you all watch out for this. That time, there was also a lecture on something which should be safer than danazol. And, you know, the GnRHs had arrived at that time, but they were expensive. And something which we give orally. And that was the time it was born, the preconceptional era of dinoges. And that time, you know, almost 15 years later, after all the trials, when dinoges actually came onto the scene, it was such a wonderful surprise for everybody. So, Asha, you know, the way you have presented that is so beautiful. I'm really, because I've lived through that era, you know, along with you. So we can actually see today's people, you know, they have access to this particular wonder drug, and of course, with GnRH. So the comments were excellent. Very good.
Thank you so much, Suchitra, for this kind words. I think the more I talk, more I'm understanding the disease.
Kalyan, Dr. Kalyan.
Dr. Asha, ma'am, I want to ask you, how you decide about whether to use the letrozole or GnRH? Because nowadays there are a few newer studies have come which have beneficial effect of letrozole as well as GnRH, also combination of these two being used in adenomyosis. So how you decide about this, ma'am?
My first choice is always GnRH analog, because that's the one which came first. You know, the GnRH analog we started using in 2005-2006. Whereas letrozole, the papers are coming only now, over last 1 year. So last 1 year, I have a group of patients who are on letrozole because the cost is marginally less. But still the cost is something like 50 rupees a day, a tablet of letrozole. So when you use it for a month, again, it is 1,500. So for 3 months, it would be about 4,500. But still, it is much better than the cost of GnRH analog. And some people have such big adenomyosis. I've used a combination also of GnRH analog and aromatase. And at the same time, I give them a Mirena, because I'm worried about the bone loss. So now we have two patients who have conceived in the last month. One is 12 weeks and one is 8 weeks. These two girls really have a big uterus, like 12 to 14 weeks. We have seen that whenever the uterine volume is more than 200 ml, the success rate for pregnancy is not so great. And even if they conceive, the chances of preterm delivery would be higher. So I believe strongly in reducing the uterine volume before getting them pregnant. So my first choice would be GnRH analog. Aromatase inhibitor is what I have started using over last 1 year. And kindly use these with progesterone add back to avoid a bone loss. Aromatase is a new kid around the block, according to me.
Thank you so much. It is useful.
I think whatever studies are available, they are saying the results are comparable. But because the study duration is still less, I think 1 year only. So we may not be able to comment upon the efficacy.
Yeah, there are less papers. There are very nice papers by Badawi and El-Nashar, Abu Bakr El-Nashar, which talk about volume reduction and reduction of size of adenomyosis. So we have to do our own studies, because we are always looking towards the West for studies. So we have such wonderful masses, you know. So I think we have to do our own studies and make papers now.
And we are happy to see Dr. Archana Verma, madam, has joined us. And so, Archana, madam, we would like to have your experience sharing also with us.
I'm sorry I was not there and when you were calling him, but I heard Dr. Asha Rao. She is my favorite and one of the best orator, I think. And for adenomyosis, no one better than Asha. Last time also, I choose her to be as an orator. And so much thanks to Dr. Ramani. And really, I want to say that there is a strong association between adenomyosis and endometriosis and infertility, of course. And the best part regarding the management is, I think if you don't think endometriosis or adenomyosis, you won't be able to diagnose it. So the diagnosis is much first step in the success of the treatment. And then, you know, the Asha has very well said, and I'm very happy to see that IUD with Danazol. Danazol was one of my favorite when we were young doctors. So we were using it right, left, that Danazol. And if it is a new one, it is very good. And this GnRH agonist, definitely better. Even we prefer, I see, because I'm not a very real infertility specialist, but whenever we refer the patient, they prefer to give GnRH agonist, and the results are definitely better. And was just see the diagnosis. I think we start better awareness, and diagnosis is really required. Thank you, Dr. Ritu.
Thank you.
And it was a wonderful deliberation by Asha Rao. Ye dil mange more, or we will be doing more webinar together.
Thank you so much, Archana, for those encouraging words.
Thank you so much, Archana ma'am. And thank you so much, Asha ma'am, for this excellent presentation. And you've really strengthened our faith into the medical management role, and your experience with so many cases really added to our valuable knowledge also.
Thank you, dear Archana, our co-chairperson.
And a very happy wedding anniversary also, Sneha.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Happy anniversary to you, ma'am.
Happy anniversary, Sneha.
Thank you, everyone.
And since we have Dr. Archana, we would request you to, we are moving on to the third presentation, and we request you to introduce Dr. Vidya Bhatt, madam.
Yeah.
Can we have the...
Oh, Dr. Vidya. Very nice. I'm very happy to introduce her. Dr. Vidya, we all know a dynamic person from Bangalore, I think. And she's a famous laparoscopic surgeon and a medical director for Radha Krishna Medical Multi-Speciality Hospital.
Read the whole thing. Just few lines and I'll start my lecture.
Okay. But I want to say much about the Vidya, but please don't stop me. And she is she has conducted many good webinars, and she's one of the very, very popular in position. She's been a president also of what is the full form of KSOGA?
KSOGA.
All Kerala.
Karnataka.
Sorry, All Karnataka Association. And she was a president of Bangalore Society, joint secretary FOCSI 2013, ICOG governing council member, and so many and so many and so many. Let's hear to Vidya, but she has already interrupted me, though I wanted to say so much.
Ma'am, thank you so much for the nice words, but I think we are running short of time. So let's.
And she wears very good saris also. If anybody wants to ask anything, you can ask her. And the beautiful, beautiful poses, I still remember. And I wish her the best in all the future endeavors.
Thanks a lot. Thank you so much, ma'am, for the nice introduction. And Ritu, ma'am, thanks a lot for this opportunity. And as usual, I would like to thank Ramani, madam, for giving me more and more opportunities in endometriosis and adenomyosis webinars. And Asha ma'am, I have no words. You always a thanks to you, because you encourage me so much. And before I really go to my topic, I would like to thank Manju ma'am and Asha ma'am for giving such a beautiful insight about endometriosis. And Asha madam, your lecture was simply wonderful, because you have not only told about adenomyosis medical management, you have added your vast experience into it, which really makes a lot of difference than just taking it from internet or books and speaking about a topic. But you have put in your own study. So that is something which is very authentic. As you said, Indian studies should come. But when all this fails, and most of the time in adenomyosis, we have no choice. When they complain of pain, we have to go to surgical management. And I would always like to wait for a surgical management with medical methods. And if that is not a criteria for us, we have to go for surgical management. So adenomyosis and surgery. One second, this is, yeah, it's okay. No, just my slides are seen. Just take this one. Okay, I'm happy. Can you see my slides?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, but just a moment. Now I think it's clear.
Yeah, it is clear.
Yeah.
Your voice also is coming out well.
Okay. Just give me a moment. Yeah. So whenever we think about a surgical management, changing. Yeah, okay. Surgical management in adenomyosis, when everything fails, when the patient is having pain, that is our first criteria to go in for surgical management. So when we divide the adenomyosis,
ma'am, sorry for interrupt, but please click on use slideshow.
Slideshow, okay. Okay.
The first slide was fine. Yeah, then it changed. Yes, now it is fine.
So, you have diffuse adenomyosis, adenomyoma, focal adenomyosis, and cystic adenomyosis. All these come in the way of the fertility of the patient. And there were a lot of studies which said about the cystic adenomyosis. Then, even in juvenile patients, young patients, we have seen a cystic adenomyoma, then diffuse, and then accessory masses. Sometimes you see an ACUM. So that also is confused by for a cystic adenomyoma, and then we have no choice but going for surgical management. Now, a complete explanation and diagnosis was given by Asha ma'am. The asymmetrical uterine enlargement, sometimes it is globular, sometimes it is diffuse, and sometimes you see focal areas of adenomyosis. Now, in this particular case, you see at the junctional zone many cystic areas, and these areas come in the way of implantation because there is the vascularity is at stake, and then there are a lot of problems which prevent the implantation. I mean, this causes implantation failure because the endometrium is not normal in this junctional zone. So when we have to think of surgical management, of course it is pain, and then when there is recurrent implantation failure, we have to think of either conservative combined management or post combined. We may have to give medical management also. Can I get this off? And then, as we already know that it is prevalent, now we are doing more and more diagnosis of it, and it is no more a disease of the fourth or fifth decade. Most of the time it is seen always, and in cases it can coexist with endometriosis. So, as I said before, adenomyomectomy in focal adenomyosis, when it is diffuse, you have to do a myometrial reduction. But though it is controversial, sometimes it is mandatory. So, in such cases, you have to do reduction. But how much and how far is the question? And only if you have an experience in this, you can decide how much of the adenomyoma has to be removed. So you have to do a cystectomy if there is a cyst, a cytoreduction, and then complete flap correction of the adenomyoma. The site, age, and desire of the future pregnancy is important. And of course, the patient's cure, and finally, the gynecologist's skill. So a skilled gynecologist should do this, because you just can't open up an adenomyosis and then think, no, I can't do this, and then go ahead with hysterectomy. Many cases have happened, so that should never be done. Initially, we would do coring. Now we have started off with flap methods so that we get a good myometrial integrity post-surgery. So when we look at the studies, yes, adenomyomectomy using a double flap has very good results is the conclusion. So initially, I used to do coring for adenomyosis. Now, how do you see adenomyosis? What happens is sometimes you get a report of a myoma, and then you are a traveling surgeon, and suddenly you put in an incision, you realize that there is no fibroid there, but it is adenomyosis. Look at the thick tissue. You can either use scissors or a monopolar hook with cutting mode. And here I'm doing coring. Now, removing the whole adenomyotic tissue is a big challenge. One is there'll be fumes. You should have a very good camera system. And second thing is just removing it from the myometrial tissue is really difficult. So you should know how much of the adenomyoma is there and how much of the tissue is you have to really scoop out. Now, once you finish the coring and removing the tissue, suturing is a big challenge. You have to always do in two layers. See to it that there is no gap in between, no hematoma formation, and then approximation has to be very good. Suppose you think there is a gap in between or a hematoma formation, it is better to take a stitch and give a neat scar, and then of course you can do morcellation. And we always put our oxidized regenerated cellulose as an addition barrier. Now this was an adenomyocyst, which initially we thought was it a ACUM, but it was not an ACUM, it was an adenomyocyst, and then we could completely separate it from the myometrium. The advantages of cyst is that you can completely separate it from the myometrium and then suture it in two layers. So subsequently the patient conceived. Then of course, sometimes the pain is so bad and she can't even wait for your medical therapy. In such cases, complete debulking has to be done. And as you start giving your vasopressin 10 units and 100 ml normal saline, you realize that the blanching takes a little time, unlike your myoma. So you have to talk to your anesthetist and give a little more than required at times, because you should get a good blanching. Otherwise, it will completely start bleeding and the field will be really bloody. And what happens is these bleeding edges can really disturb your surgical steps. So in this particular case, there was a huge posterior wall adenomyosis, and the patient had so much of pain that no medical therapy could really give her relief. So that's when we decided with adenomyomectomy. And you can see the whole adenomyoma. We are going up to the base and removing it. And a pre-scan or an MRI, a good TVS and a 3D scan will help. And if at all the patient can afford an MRI, just to see the extent. So what we did was posteriorly, we removed the adenomyoma. Anteriorly also there was a adenomyotic tissue which we released, and then what we did was we put the flap, the anterior flap, closed the posterior flap, and then completely obliterated the adenomyotic area, and complete suturing was done. And then we gave 6 months of gap to the patient, then did a repeat hysteroscopy to see the cavity, and then proceeded with her ART procedure. So look at the flap method. You have taken the anterior layer and then gone to the posterior layer and completely approximated like a double flap, approximated like compared to a double flap, and then got a good outcome of the surgery. And then this was a adenomyoma. You can see the adenomyoma here. Young girl, but with a huge adenomyoma. So this is something which will cause a lot of pain and it will encroach into the uterine cavity and cause a lot of disturbance. So of course, here also we gave vasopressin, and then you have to take care that you don't destroy the tubes. So when you're separating the adenomyoma, you should see the extent of the adenomyoma and then go ahead and remove the adenomyoma. So in this particular case, we separated the adenomyoma, and then completely the adenomyoma was removed and we sutured it. Now the tube is at the side, there is ovarian ligament, so care has to be taken that there is no injury and complete removal has to be done. Now when you remove such an adenomyoma, approximation becomes very difficult because you get a wide separation of the uterine surface. So you have to take flaps and then bring it closer and approximate it to give a very good suturing, and then suture in two layers. So it will take a little more time to suture, but getting a very good outcome is important. So barbed sutures has really made a difference in adenomyotic surgeries. So whenever we do hysteroscopy and then we see the lesions, these lesions have to be cauterized and they have to be even resected. So you get different lesions like this, which are very close to the cavity, and sometimes it is through and through the cavity. So this was an ACUM in a young girl, which was diagnosed in such a way that it was ACUM, and then we realized that it was adenomyosis, because the histopathology came as adenomyosis. Initially, we thought it was an HCUM, and we put the thinnest resectoscope and tried removing it. Now, when we were trying to separate that, it was a big challenge because it was a almost 3.5 centimeter adenomyosis, and we were trying to resect it with a Gubini hysteroscope, which was a big challenge because it just brings out small areas of pieces. So this will cause a lot of problem because you can continuously you're doing, and then the volume size of that adenomyosis will not come down. So what we did was we took ultrasound guidance, because at times when you're doing hysteroscopic surgery, you need to take ultrasound guidance also, because the whole cavity was normal. This was at the isthmic level. It was pretty difficult to resect it because the whole tissue was not coming out. We were getting very small chunks. So then what we did was we put in a hysteroscopic morcellator. And once we put in the hysteroscopic morcellator, the wall opened up. See, you can see we took ultrasound guidance and then we could see the cyst, and then we put in the hysteroscopic morcellator. Once the morcellator was in, then you can see it churning the tissue. So it will start eating up the tissue, and we could enter the cavity. And the moment we entered the cavity, the fluid inside the cyst, that is the adenomyotic fluid, came out. And once this came out, the cyst completely collapsed and we could remove it out in completely. And then we did a repeat hysteroscopy and saw the cavity was completely normal. And this histopathology came as adenomyosis. So sometimes in hysteroscopy, you have such challenges, and this has to be tackled judiciously, because using the right instrument at the right time is important. Otherwise, we may land up with problems, or incomplete surgery can be done. So one has to be careful. If there are small lesions, then cauterizing it either with the loop electrode or even with your Versa point can be done. Sometimes you see a cyst like this, which is almost jutting into the cavity, and then once you open it, you realize that it is a adenomyosis. Now, nothing much has to be done for that. Take a loop electrode and then you completely remove the margins and the cyst. And then what happens is whatever fluid is inside just comes out, and then the cavity is formed. But this is a culprit which was causing infertility for the patient. The moment we removed and put her on an estrogen progesterone combination, it was normal. We could see a normal cavity, and then the lady conceived. So you can see this ultrasound picture. This was the adenomyosis initially, and then post removal, this was the picture, and we got a very good outcome. So this is how you take care of the lesions. And sometimes there are adhesions also like this because of the adenomyotic lesion, and you get blue areas like this. So that can be removed with hysteroscopy. Just for the completion, I'm just showing you this video of TCRE. In this particular case, it was adenomyotic tissue, and doing TCRE was a big challenge. But as we were talking, that saving the uterus is mandatory now. We can't go on doing hysterectomy for all the patients who complain of bleeding and pain, and young patients, especially 32, 33 years, we should not be doing hysterectomy. So in this particular case, what I did was I was doing TCRE because there was a lot of lesions at the junctional zone. And then it was really difficult to do TCRE because you can see the tissue is so difficult, and removal was a big challenge. And then as we went a little closer, let me just remove this. Sorry, I think it's not playing. Okay, I'll just not show that. Can we play that video? Just give me a moment. I'll play that video. Let's fast forward the video. Fast forward the video. Mm-hmm. Let me just close this. We can do. I can't close this. I can't fast forward this video. But posteriorly, we could see a huge adenomyotic lesion, which we removed, as I showed you in the previous video. So the moment we removed that, adenomyotic fluid came out, I mean the chocolate fluid, and then we could see a nice cavity there. Initially, I thought I had perforated, but we could see a nice cavity. And then I removed the cavity also, and I put the patient on Marina now, and the patient is really doing well. So adenomyomectomy and pregnancy, as it was told before, that can be preterm birth, scar rupture. So that is very important. We should take care. So a proper suturing has to be done. 6 months gap before conception has to be given. We should check for vascularity with Doppler and then allow the patient to either conceive spontaneously or go in for IVF ICSI, and repeat hysteroscopy if required to be done. And single embryo transfer is preferred in such patients because the scars are really bad at times. So depending upon the patient's lesion, one should take up for surgery, because the more advanced age, the surgery may not be really helpful. The younger patients benefit from surgery. So pregnancy rates are 46%, menorrhagia decreases, and then there is relief from pain to up to 81%. So now, of course, we are thinking of LNG IUGS for so many patients, and they are really doing well, and there is enough and more evidence. When we have adenomyosis, we give a combined therapy, and with combined therapy, many are doing very well. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Vidya. It was really a fantastic presentation, and with those amazing videos and the hysteroscopic approach, I think we really enjoyed and we learned a lot from these. And I would request Dr. Ramani Devi ma'am to give her expert opinion and her experience sharing. Ramani ma'am, are you there, madam? Dr. Kalyan is there.
Yeah, Dr. Vidya ma'am, it was really, really mesmerizing talk, and I was so happy to see your adenomyosis, which you have done hystroscopically. It is really a treat to watch these surgeries. I'm really thankful that I could attend this, because hystroscopic, I have rarely done these cases. Lap adenomyomectomy we are doing routinely, but hystroscopic adenomyosis is really something to learn, and I'm really thankful to that. Was such a nice lecture, and Dr. Pai, you can add.
Yeah, I have been a big fan of Dr. Vidya and her surgery. She is the best part of her is that she is very simple, and she is very modest in her presentation. But she is a much bigger surgeon than that, and she has got excellent results, and. The earlier two speakers also, I was just appreciating. They gave an excellent idea about the adenomyosis. So the next part is going to be easier. Dr. Asha Rao, as well as Dr. Those who spoke on the basics of adenomyosis and the treatment. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Pai, sir.
Dr. Ramani Devi, ma'am.
Yeah. Dr. Vidya, I think it was just a super visual treat of looking at your surgeries. Fantastic. I think there is still a role of surgery in adenomyosis and infertility, because we cannot 100% rely on the medical management, because still the larger uteri, adenomyotic uteri, or a focal adenomyotic uterus, I think surgical management is definitely
CPD.
Maybe surgery followed by GnRH analogs, either pre or that is prior to embryo transfer, that definitely helps. I can share one of my experience with the adenomyotic patient whom I was planning for an ART, but she wanted to go for a surgery and try. So I told her that I will go ahead with the surgery, but I am not sometime back. I am not that much trained in adenomyotic lap surgery, but I had done an open surgery with a good suturing. To my surprise, that patient came back after 4 months with pregnancy. So just mere correction of adenomyotic lesion does help. And I would like to share one more of my patient who was referred to me for hysterectomy at the age of 32 years because she had a 16-week size adenomyoma. No, I said, no, you take GnRH 3 months depot, then come back. But she came back after 6 months telling that she has vomiting and she has not got her periods. After she took the injection, to my surprise, she came with a pregnancy. And subsequently, that patient was put on LNG IUS in the intermediary phase before planning for the next pregnancy. And next pregnancy also, she had an ovulation induction with the IUI. So we have, I think, similar experience many of us would have had in our practice. We have to choose which is the correct one, whether we need to choose the medical management followed by ART or surgical management. it has to be individualized. Anyway, with all this current medical managements that are available, we can definitely improve the outcome of fertility in adenomyotic patients. Thank you all, Dr. Vidya. Thanks to Dr. Kimeni, Dr. Ashara for their wonderful lectures. Thank you. Next, we'll be having the images coming up.
Vidya, congratulations.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Congratulations to all the speakers. We got excellent presentations and I think we learned such a lot, but we are still awaiting more and more and coming up with good case presentations. And with the urge of the perimenopausal age, where one feels to relax in life, the enigma of adenomyosis sometimes may lay its trap. But is there anybody to help in this nightmare of adenomyosis? For this, yes, we have our young stars of this program. To come up with the first young star was Dr. Saumil Trivedi, who's done his fellowship in minimal access surgery, gynecology, fellowship in obstetrics and gynec ultrasound, training in robotic surgery in New York, USA. Dr. Saumil is a gynecological endoscopist, sonologist, infertility and urogynec consultant, the co-director of Dr. Trivedi's Total Healthcare Private Limited and Akar IVF Center, a author of the 10 publications and a recipient of Foxy Tony Rudra Sinha Prize for the best endoscopic video at AICOG Agra, and presented also a lot of videos and has been in the managing committee AIJE. And joining with him and on to go on with the evidence-based recommendations, we have the expert with us and who's no other than Dr. Muralidhar Pai, a passionate teacher and axical orator and whose work really speaks for himself. He's a professor and head of department, Ops Gynec, KMC Manipal, the chairman, Medical Education Committee, South Asia Federation of Gynec, and the member of the Governing Council of Indian College of Obstetricians. He's got so many awards and medal, 8 times the best teacher, 3 times the best teaching material awards at KMC Manipal. And he's been the author to books and has received 3 Foxy National Awards, so many publications, and that list goes on. So I would request Dr. Saumil to present the case on the perimenopausal bleeding with adenomyosis.
Thank you so much, Madam, Ritu Madam and Asha Madam and Ramani Devi Madam for giving me this opportunity to be amongst our giants and amongst Dr. Muralidhar Pai as the expert for my case presentation. It's truly an honor. I'll just start my screen sharing. Is my screen visible?
Yeah.
So thank you again. Without any further ado, I will firstly just, instead of presenting one case to cover more possibilities, I'm going to be sharing some case scenarios possible in the perimenopausal age group on adenomyosis. So coming to the first scenario, this is a 44-year-old lady who is Mrs. XYZ, presented with the chief complaints of worsening dysmenorrhea and menorrhagia, which has progressively increased over the past 1 year. She had similar complaints in the past, but they were sporadic and there was some resolution on medical management. Her menstrual history entailed she had 6 to 8 days of heavy flow of bleeding with clots associated with pain, which was usually starting premenstrually and elevating by day 5, day 6. Her obstetric history is as mentioned, she has had 2 full-term LSCS with 2 miscarriages and an MTP. And DNC was done for the 2 miscarriages. She underwent tubal sterilization along with the 2nd LSCS. Apart from that, she does not have any significant past medical or surgical history. On pelvic examination, we found that the uterus was about 12 to 14 weeks in size with mildly restricted mobility. The adnexa seemed unremarkable and the ultrasound revealed a bulky uterus with posterior asymmetric thickening with foci of hypoechoic spots in the myometrium, and the features were suggestive of adenomyotic uterus. As a workup, a CA-125 was done, which was 148. So just giving a gist of the case summary out here to Dr. Pai. She's a perimenopausal lady with worsening dysmenorrhea and menorrhagia, completed family with no fertility desires whatsoever. USG suggestive of a diffuse adenomyotic uterus. This patient was apparently fed up with the problems and wanted some permanent remedial measures for the same. So, sir, I would like to, I mean, even though the debate is about uterine conservation, I still do believe that hysterectomy remains one of the most age-old treatment, which is obviously a very plausible treatment which can be offered. My question to you before that is, would you like to do something else in the investigative workup? What mode of imaging would you prefer for this woman?
Yeah. See, as the previous speakers have told, even today, the best first mode of investigation would be transvaginal sonography.
Right, sir.
If you have 3D and if you have high resolution ultrasound, nothing like that. Very, very rarely we need to do MRI. Of course, Doppler helps us in differentiating between coexisting fibroids, especially if there are any degenerations in that. The difference between the Doppler findings in adenomyosis and fibroids being, in fibroids, you will have a peripheral blood flow and in the intralesional, whereas in the and adenomyosis, you will see translesional Doppler findings. But that hardly makes much of a difference for us. The most important thing is to find out whether there are any coexisting fibroids here. And that's why probably in your case, the uterus is slightly bigger. Usually, adenomyosis will not cross the pelvis. That's what we say. So probably your case has got both adenomyosis as well as fibroids. The best part of our case is here. She's 44 years and she doesn't want any children anymore. So there's not much of dilemma there. Yeah, beautifully you have done this, what I have said. And one more thing, yes, elastography now is a new boon, what you have shown here. This will differentiate between a benign lesion and a malignant lesion. We need to always see, because all these problems are, the underlying problem is hyperhistogenism, right? Whether it is endometriosis, adenomyosis or fibroid. And these things will flourish in the backdrop of that. And we should ask also the family history of possible endometrial CA and other things.
Right.
So that's why the elastography is now very useful to differentiate whether there's any malignant element in this. And I'm happy that you have you are showing a picture of all the three, the right. Transvaginal sonography with the Doppler and the elastography. Would you like to explain that to the audience?
So yeah, so basically, as you very correctly pointed out, one differentiating feature between a fibroid and adenomyosis or a focal adenomyosis would be, as you mentioned, on Doppler, a peripheral blood supply with intralesional invading blood supply, whereas compared to that, an adenomyosis would have more of a translesional blood supply. And elastography, as you, it actually basically picks up the firmness of the mass which you are seeing. So typically, a fibroid would appear on the elastography appearing slightly bluish, which indicates a firmer consistency, whereas that in adenomyosis due to slightly soft consistency would be greenish blue. So that is a point which I really like to mention here. And obviously all the previous speakers have mentioned beautifully the changes in the junctional zone and the various other parameters like myometrial cysts and everything as elaborated by the previous speakers.
Swamil, one more thing with going with the investigation,
right.
It is always advisable in this special perimenopausal age group also to have an endometrial sampling.
Right, sir.
It is better to rule out if there is any ATPR, especially.
Right.
Then we will be more justified in doing, in a radical treatment that is hysterectomy.
Right, sir.
If there's any element of ATPR. Yeah.
Right.
Go ahead.
So I wouldn't be elaborating much on the video, but just some pointers, as this case was more of a isolated adenomyosis, and because of her previous history of two cesareans, as you can see, it was a ventrofixed uterus,
yes.
Which was completely plastered to the anterior abdominal wall. Fortunately,
and you had to do bladder dissection probably.
Fortunately, we were lucky to not have associated bad peritoneal and rectovaginal endometriosis in this case. Now, just certain precautions, what precautions do you take in bladder dissection due to previous LSCS in such cases? And I am someone who is trained basically to do uterines at the origin right from my beginning journey of laparoscopic surgery. So do you recommend that should be practiced or done in all cases routinely?
Actually, not required. Maybe because you are used to that you are doing. There's no need to go up till that level unless you are suspecting any malignancies or anything like that. Otherwise, right. There's really no need of that, I guess.
Right. So this was very interesting. Actually, at one point, I did fear that I have opened up the bladder accidentally.
Yeah, it looks like that.
But I was fortunate not to see any Foley's catheter inside and just realized that it's probably a correct plane of wind, yes. correct plane of cleavage and just a window.
There will be always some fluid in the POD pockets and you will get scared.
This was because of the peritoneal adhesions, there was some loculated fluid. So it did misguide and... for a moment, there was a fear, but we must remember that bladder is a very forgiving organ per se. So as I already mentioned that I normally prefer doing a direct approach to the uterine artery for any hysterectomy. And this is the posterior approach which is being followed. And I will not enumerate too much about this because you just identify the ureter, observe the peristalsis, identify it at the pelvic brim. And the first horizontal offshoot as seen here from the internal iliac is the uterine artery. And the same procedure is repeated on the other side. So this, as I mentioned, was a fairly straightforward thing and still remains one of the age-old treatment offered to probably everyone. Now, coming to the second summary, I'll not narrate too much of details. Basically, a woman with the same profile, having almost the same features with USG suggestive of diffuse adenomyotic uterus, but the patient is hellbent that she wants the issue resolved, but does not want removal of the uterus. So sometimes this is a challenge, and I would want to know your opinion as to what non-surgical management would you like to offer to this patient to alleviate her problem.
There are several non-surgical things offered. One of them is, as you have shown here, the Mirena. That's really the good one because the main problem with adenomyosis is menorrhagia and pain.
Right.
And Mirena is an excellent thing which will take care of the menorrhagia and also a little bit of the pain. Will be relieved with that. I personally won't choose OC pills at this age because right. Of its drawbacks. Mirena is the excellent one. People also have thought of uterine artery embolization as one of the other choices, which is okay. A meta-analysis has showed that it has got even excellent results even in the younger patients who wanted to conceive. The other new thing, it's not really new, it's been there last 5 years, is the MRG FUS. That is another option which is not really excellent for adenomyosis, but the latter two, that is uterine artery embolization and MRG FUS, are still in the experimental stage, I should say. So, as of now, Mirena will be the excellent choice for her to relieve the symptoms. And as far as pain is concerned, she can back up this with some Meftal or something like that. That is mefenamic acid.
So one challenge that sometimes some can face in a clinical practice is that whenever you say that, for just patient explanation purposes, we say that we'll put in a loop in your uterus and many people will resist. No, loop nahi chahiye. Because they have had misconceptions that it causes bleeding, some amount of pain. So would you prefer to do a trial of progesterone or Dynogest or something to see whether it's working and then counsel them to go in for a Mirena? Of course,
you have to counsel a lot to these patients because I think the misconception is due to a bad experience with the copper T. Usually increases the bleeding, sometimes menorrhagia, and there can be some crampy pains with that. So we have to really spend some time and telling the patient that this is something like copper T, but it doesn't have copper in that. Instead, it has got progesterone, the same thing which you would be taking by tablets. I usually tell the patients, instead of taking tablets every day, Jhanjat, this is better for you. It will sit there in the place and work for you. However, we must remember, Mirena will not act from tomorrow, if I insert today. So we have to, with or without Mirena, we have to give some backup of progesterone initially. And progesterone can be of your choice. You can give either medroxyprogesterone or you can give Dynogest, which is better. Nowadays, we can straight away put them on Dynogest for 2 months at least, till Mirena takes over.
Right. And sir, any issues you have found with Mirena use? Because sometimes patients are troubled initially with having too much of periods and then suddenly when periods go away also is a problem to a lot of patients.
Yeah.
And how do you manage some amount of erratic bleeding and bleeding?
So that this all, see, our human mind is actually very luckily, it can be, it is subjected to all our suggestions. So the how you suggest them, how you tell them right in the beginning. So if you tell them right in the beginning, you have to anticipate some irregularity of the cycles, because it's only progesterone there. There is no estrogen there. And estrogen is the good cycle controller. So that's why OC pills, they will get perfect cycles. Whereas with Mirena, there is only progesterone there. And we must tell them, anticipate some amount of irregular periods, and that will go away. And you will totally stop bleeding. And they should, we should tell them stopping bleeding is actually a good thing for you. Otherwise, they will think that the blood is getting collected in the uterus. That is another headache.
Yes.
So it all depends upon how nicely we educate them. Right. And then they will wonderfully accept it. And now you should tell also that, you know, irregular periods, all that you need to do is use pads for some time. Otherwise, that will also be a headache. There, some religious people, they would like to avoid this, because they say, I don't know when I'm going to have the bleeding, so I can't go to temple and this and that. So that part also you have to anticipate and inform them.
Right. So moving ahead, another scenario, almost similar, similar profile, completed family with no fertility desire, but instead of a diffuse adenomyosis, this lady has a posterior focal adenomyoma, which is of 7 to 8 centimeters. And as the earlier patient, she is okay with surgery, but does not want removal of the uterus.
You are suggesting to me and tempting me to say that if it is focal, best is to go with your surgical skills. Go ahead and show the video.
Right. So this was a lady wherein typically there are a lot of methods in which adenomyosis is nowadays addressed. And we saw some beautiful videos by Vidya Madam. So this lady had a posterior focal adenomyoma, which was about 8 centimeters. Now, sir, I would like to know, many of the times the mistake in surgery that can be made is attempting full excision of an adenomyoma, because there can be so much of myometrial loss that it will be difficult to actually put things back together.
Yes.
So do you plan going in an adenomyomectomy with a predetermined sonographic margin of resection or anything of that sort?
No, it is always good to have an idea to know the extent of the the adenomyoma, and it is better we try to remove as much as possible, and it is always better to map whether we are encroaching on the cavity, especially in a younger lady.
Right.
Older lady it may not matter much, but in a younger lady where you are trying to preserve her uterus for the fertility purposes, better not to go to the extent of opening the cavity and things like that. And the meta-analysis has shown that with the best of the surgeons like you, there can still be uterine rupture. Right. In the future pregnancy. Of course, this particular patient, we are not worried about that. But in a younger lady, when you do adenomyomectomy for fertility preservations, better not to go to the extent of going to the cavity, entirely removing everything. Remove at least most of it and keep the myometrium for a good, buttressing. Like, you have to keep 3 layers of two layers, like
Usada's technique. So one point, because I have trained with Dr. Sanjay Patel in my learning years, who obviously has a very good volume of adenomyosis done. Now he uses something called as a slicing technique, wherein he will just slice the posterior part of the uterus if that is thickened and leave it unsutured in a patient desirous of fertility. And in fact, one of the challenges that sometimes we might face is that the tissue, when we are suturing it back together, especially with use of barbed sutures, sometimes it is so friable that it just keeps cutting through.
True.
In fact, his recommendation in many of the adenomyosis, this thing, I would want you to disagree on this, but is to do a good single layer deep interrupted closure. Do you agree with that? This is the same thing which I have done out here. So I've not done a multi-layered closure. Obviously now we have shifted to a more flap kind of a method of closure. But sometimes even a good interrupted closure, even in patients who are desirous to conceive and subsequently have become pregnant, obviously there will be a need for
I would like to, at this juncture, tell you the way the uterus heals.
Right.
The way uterus heals is slightly different from the other tissues in the body heal. See, other tissues, they heal by almost always by fibrosis.
Right.
But whereas the uterus heals by regeneration of the myometrium. This is what I learned, when I was you know, trying to write a chapter on the post-caesarean, you know, cases. So, as you must have, or most of us have seen that in a post-caesarean case, when we open the UV fold of peritoneum, we hardly see the previous scar. We don't see the scar at all. Whereas on the abdomen, the scar is so nicely seen.
Right.
So that's what I meant by the way uterus heals is different from the way the rest of the tissues in the body heal. So if you put one layer or two layers, I think it doesn't matter much. The uterus heals beautifully on its own. But of course, you should not keep a wide gap. If you keep a wide gap, then like I don't agree with the slicing and leaving it alone. I don't know. It's your teacher, but I'm sorry to comment that, on that. But I don't know whether you agree with him.
Sir, I've never tried it personally myself, but that is what he speaks about a series. Obviously, yeah. He's had some cases.
It is always better to at least approximate the edges so that you give them a chance to come together and heal faster and prevent probably adhesions with the you know, intestines and other things. That's the most important
thing. That is actually one of the challenges that he says in his series, is that there have been very bad cases of posterior adhesion sometimes.
Absolutely. Because see,
sometimes also to the extent that when the incision was made on the anterior segment, the rent on the posterior part was bigger than the anterior.
These
are some of the challenges that have been encountered, and I just wanted
to here we have to use the principle of first do no harm. Patient has come for a solution. We can't do a counterproductive thing. Right. You have done a successful surgery already of adenomyosis, but then you are giving her a problem of adhesions and bad problems because of that. So that's where I sort of disagree.
Right.
Do apologies.
No issues, sir. That's why I wanted an expert opinion of yours as well. Sir, just a word about this procedure, because now we are in the era of nerve sparing surgery. Everything is nerve sparing. And this is not something that we do too often, but in an absolutely isolated midline adenomyosis, especially when uterus conservation is a thing which the patient demands, when there is not too much of peritoneal endometriosis associated, we have had series of almost 108 cases wherein presacral neurectomy was done. Do you consider this procedure at all useful, or should it be counted as obsolete now?
Somil, after you posed this question to me yesterday during the discussion, I went and searched in the literature. There is an excellent meta-analysis of more than 400 cases of neurectomy starting from 1997.
Right, sir.
So the initial paper said this is a good procedure as far as the relief of pain is concerned, but it has got a lot of side effects. Side effects like constipation, bladder, you know, problems, and you know, all those things. But now, the recent works with excellent surgeons like you, who are very careful in doing the surgery and you are actually not going to damage much, it is not a bad option at all, you know, for a relief of pain especially. And the side effects which they saw in the initial papers are not really seen nowadays. So you can select your cases where the person, because see, now I recall one of my talks where I said the pain relief has got three aspects of it. Number one is the nociceptive pain, which is relieved by removal of the endometriotic tissue. The second one is inflammatory pain, which is taken care of by the tablets alone, like mefenamic acid. The third pain is the neurogenic pain, which has to be taken care of sometimes by these kind of neurectomies. So it is like a three-pronged attack. You remove the adenomyosis and endometriotic tissue to take care of the nociceptive pain. You give them the medication to take care of the inflammatory pain. And you do the neurectomies, or LUNA also is another procedure to take care of the neuronal pain. I think you can, it is not obsolete definitely. You can improvise your technique, but you can collect your cases.
In fact, I'll like to mention in the 108 cases done at our center, we did have two cases which complained of insensory loss of urine, as in the patient didn't
know,
but it was transient. It was transient only for 36 to 48 hours, and then the function was resumed. In fact, we followed up the series very well. Very few patients actually have the side effects which have been reported in literature. In fact, they give an accessory benefit, especially when done for a fertility issue. They also said that we had good painless labor. As an add-on benefit of the procedure.
Yeah, it's a beneficial effect.
So obviously, as mentioned there, and as shown very beautifully by Vidya, but there is the OSADA or the flap technique of closure which can be used. Now, coming to the last scenario, sir, nowadays, even in the age group of, say, 42, 45, there will be still patients who may be perimenopausal, but still keen on conception. So this lady did not have too much of heavy, she had slight heavy bleeding with occasional dysmenorrhea, but her main issue was she was keen to conceive. She was having secondary infertility. She has had one previous LSCS and two miscarriages. But her uterus was almost 14 weeks in size with restricted mobility, but she had diffuse adenomyotic uterus. She had undergone two IVF cycles which had failed. The AMH was 0.8. The semen analysis parameters were normal. CA125 was 48. We took a decision of doing hysterolaparoscopy, and these were the findings. The uterine cavity was absolutely normal with both the ostia well visualized and healthy. The uterus was obviously diffusely enlarged. So this is just showing you the pictorial view of the findings. The ostia both were visualized. The cavity was good in volume without any indenting mass lesion in the cavity. And this was the picture on laparoscopy, wherein the uterus was bulky. The ovary and the tubes were externally normal, but patency was only found in the right-sided tube. So how would you go ahead managing this case? Would you be tempted to do a surgery in such a scenario, or would you, as mentioned by all the previous
speakers? Swamil, can you hear me? Because maybe there's some internet issues.
We can hear you very well, sir.
Okay. No, because my screen showed that your internet is unstable. So that's why I was worried.
No.
Anyway, Swamil, this case is not a simple case. It's a googly.
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you had told me she was 45 years, I could have safely said, just leave her alone.
Right.
Okay. But now you are putting it as 42, still 3 more years of trial.
Right.
And she has got a very low AMH. She had a previous cesarean. And she has got two failed IVF. Things are not straightforward. Of course, if the patient is forcing us, requesting us, we cannot dishonor her request. Yes? So we may go ahead and counsel her very nicely, properly, tell her everything. She has to take a considered decision, because tomorrow, after all that, if she doesn't conceive, then she will be in for very big disappointment. So with all the caveats, you can go ahead. What you have done is a correct step, that you can do a hysteroscopy. If there's nothing problem there, you can do a laparoscopy. But I think the uterus is little very big. She may be having fibroids as well, I feel. Because 14 to 16 weeks is a very big size.
Scan.
And if you try to do resection, you are going to remove big chunk of uterus. And she's definite case for rupture of uterus.
Right.
So with all this, I think we can counsel her nicely, convince her. She has one child. I mean, it's wrong for me to tell her that, be happy with that.
Right, sir. But that is the challenge that sometimes we do face.
I understand totally.
And sir, what you mentioned,
you have to face the patient and honor the patient's request.
What you mentioned was actually true. There were some small fibroids, but none of a significant size that, you know, like we would deem it appropriate to actually core up the entire myometrium to remove probably 1.5 centimeter fibroids. There were multiple fibroids with associated adenomyosis in this case. So in fact, how we manage this, as mentioned by all the previous speakers, was give a long protocol and give long suppression of GnRH analogs for almost 3 months. We did attempt one cycle of self oocyte retrieval, but that unfortunately, because of the low AMH, did not give a very great response. And we convinced her to go in for egg donor treatment. And fortunately, we were able to make her conceive, but she had a miscarriage in this situation. Apparently, now that we have followed her up, as you rightly mentioned, we have told her it's best sometimes to not aim for a second pregnancy. But that is something which is, I mean, like, I don't know whether she is not coming for follow-up because I mentioned that to her, and she has gone elsewhere is something which is a dilemma for me. So those were some of the scenarios. I'll just be showing one important aspect in the video. I don't want to This was very beautifully covered by Vidya Madam, that is hysteroscopic resection. Now, the only tricky thing that I want to show, because my experience with hysteroscopic adenomyoma resection was very limited. It was a time wherein I actually felt that I have perforated the uterus, wherein it can just be a focal collection and it just goes in. You almost feel that you are seeing the peritoneal cavity via the hole, but it in fact was a
focal. It's the base of the cyst, maybe.
Right. So I just wanted to show that aspect. I think in a second, you will visualize wherein you actually feel as if this is a perforation. And to my surprise, when I tried to put in the, I was being a little naughty because I was not seeing any loss of distension. So that was something which gave me courage. I went in with the scope and I was actually very happy to see a normal uterine cavity beneath that. So that is something just I wanted to share with you all. Sir, coming to the end of the session, I would just like to conclude with you giving just one remark about each of these. I would like to call them a rapid fire round.
Okay.
In perimenopausal edema, it'll take just 1 minute, madam. Sorry for slight extension. In
you want one word answers?
One word answers. One word is also fine,
no.
Sir.
Ocipils, okay. No.
Progesterone, dinogest, cyclical, continuous.
You can choose better ones.
Any thoughts about use of ormeloxifene for adenomyosis?
No.
NSAIDs and antifibrinolytics?
Yes, of course. You have to give them.
Aromatase inhibitors?
You can try.
Depot progesterones?
Yeah, instead of that, Mirena is better.
And GnRH agonist, according to me, definitely has its
place. You can give anyway to push her faster into menopause.
Right, sir. Some of these things have already been covered, so yeah. I'll briefly skip them. Progesterone, IUDs, uterine artery. So one point that uterine artery embolization and MRI-guided focus ultrasound do work very poorly when we are dealing with adenomyosis. And sometimes
That's what I said.
The side effect just profile also is bad. So this question I want to ask, because many times we get patients who are being seen by their family physicians and generalists who still recommend a DNC. Do you think there is a place of DNC at all? So hysteroscopic resection, adenomyomectomy and hysterectomy.
Vidya also shown, you can do
that. Sir, role of CA125 in adenomyosis.
No, better not to waste money.
Any other markers?
No, not really.
Method of choice for investigation?
All of them.
All of them. Okay. MRI for all?
Selective.
If so, in whom? In whom would you like to do an MRI?
Yeah, if you have a doubt regarding, the extent of the MRI, extent of the adenomyosis, and if you have, still some doubts with regards to the loss of this junctional zone and all those things, then MRI is better. And you want to really see whether if there is fibroid and if there's degeneration, mixed picture, confusing picture, then yes.
Coexistent endometriosis, would you like to do an MRI for such situations if there was...
No, endometriosis, again, nowadays, ultrasound itself is good enough, not even laparoscopy to diagnose.
Right.
Even though laparoscopy is the gold standard, endometriosis can be beautifully diagnosed by ultrasound unless there is no cyst at all or, in the very initial stages. But then that would, you would do put a laparoscope only if she has got symptoms to take care of that ablation and things like that.
All right. So with that, thank you so much for all your inputs. And thank you to all the esteemed members and to Ramani Devi Madam, Ritu Khanna Madam for having me and allowing me this opportunity to present various case scenarios and learning from all you giants. Thank you so much, madam. Thank you.
You are the giants now. You people are the giants, youngsters, because we are now trying to learn from you, because you have got the very good skills. You have the, even Tendulkar has to retire at the age of 40. The youngster will do better. Right. Because initially people were talking about Tendulkar, I'm using the same analogy. So after sometimes we lose our reflexes. You guys have got the better reflexes and your heart is more bolder, lion hearts you have got. We have become little older. So excellent presentation.
Always a pleasure to learn from all your experience and expertise, sir. Thank you so much.
You can only now tell what not to do.
Okay. Dr. Murli and Dr. Saumil, that was an excellent conversation, I should say. And all his surgeries were too good. And one thing about the rapid fire, what you did, I think Arlenoxifen still has a place in adenomyosis, because I use it like when I introduce LNIUS, maybe the first 3 to 4 months, the patient can have irregular spotting.
Yes,
at
yes.
that time, I give Arlenoxifen. Definitely, it has an impact upon the bleeding pattern. Okay. So they totally go in. That has got some role. Still, Arlenoxifen has got some role. Anyway, thank you, both of you. Thank you, Dr.
Saumil and Dr. Muralidhar Pai. I think you kept Dr. Pai on wheels all the time. And
with a rapid fire also.
Yeah, yeah. He didn't leave you till the end. And I think
he's a hero.
Yeah.
So he has to behave like that.
I think every sunrise is a gift and every patient is a learning. Right. And the panel of yours, like yours, every learning is a boon. So with this, I move on to the next case scenario. Adolescent age has its own ups and downs in the new horizon, like the waves in the ocean. So on top of it, the nagging adenomyosis affects her day-to-day activity, social life, and actually she feels she's just out of the world. So we have another rising star with us today. And that's Dr. Rohan Krishnakumar with us, who will find the best solutions for us. Dr. Rohan, Fellowship in Gynec Oncology, Fellowship in Minimal Excess Surgery, Fellowship in Advanced MIS in Endometriosis and Cancer Surgery from Italy, Training in Gynec Oncology, MD Anderson Cancer Hospital, Laparoscopic and Cancer Surgeon, Consulting Obstetrician and Gynecologist, Endoscopic Surgeon at JK Women's Hospital, Dabbeville. Knowledge, skills and experience matters and always helps us. So we have with us the expert who is so meticulous, with fantastic surgical skills, and his passion really speaks for himself, and that's Dr. Nagendra Sadesh Pandey. He's a consultant endoscopic surgeon, Bombay Hospital, Sir HN Reliance Hospital, Breach Candy Hospital, and so many other hospitals to there. Publications and presentations in national international journals, laparoscopic correction of chronic uterine inversion in JMIG 2009, with special interests into endometriosis and laparoscopic radical surgery. So over to you, Dr. Rohan.
Just share my screen. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Thanks to all the seniors and organizers. It's always a pleasure to learn, and a very good learning experience for a youngster like me. So as in the previous, I hope I'm audible.
Yes, very much.
As previously, we just saw in the previous presentation, Saumil had a good chance of presenting his surgeries in one end of the horizon, whereas my topic comes to the beginning part, wherein people are more, as Madam rightly described, it is a phase of life wherein young women are eager to begin their careers, eager to live their lives, and at that time they face with such dilemmas. So it's about adolescent adenomyosis, a dilemma. So I'll just share my screen and go ahead. Before starting, I would just like to introduce this unique IAGE conference. I hope everyone registers for this. And going ahead, so what is early onset endometriosis? It's predominantly a disease of women of the reproductive age group. It's it's usually not uncommon in adolescents, with the majority of these conditions in which the women start reporting symptoms early. An early diagnosis and optimal management during adolescence is warranted. Endometriosis can be documented as early as the premenarchal age group. The mean age wherein the symptoms might begin is between 11 to 22 years, and that's where the main adolescence age group comes under. And almost 70% of such people fail the initial medical management. As you can see, most of the symptoms in almost 38% of women start presenting early, before the age of 15. Due to this nature of the disease, you can see that there at least require 4 to 5 physician consultations before a proper diagnosis is reached, which is very disturbing for a women or girls in that age group. And a mean time from onset of symptoms till diagnosis is almost as late as 22 months. So EOE, as in early onset endometriosis, is progressive and usually presents with endometriomas. But the topic given to me today is adenomyosis, which one of the theories could be neonatal uterine bleeding, which occurs. And this leads to adenomyoma. I've just put this slide to show that in adult endometriosis, one of the common presenting factors is adenomyoma. But when it comes to adolescence, nowhere you can see an adenomyoma seen. That is, it's one of the rarest things that could be encountered, which presents not only to the physician a dilemma, but also to the patient to choose what type of treatment she wants. So coming to the first case, I think I'll just present a brief history. She's a 19-year-old unmarried female presented with chronic abdominal pain, severe dysmenorrhea since the last 2 years. She's been taking conservative management and in the form of NSAIDs on and off for symptomatic relief. But dysmenorrhea has persistently worsened over the last 6 months. And she's also had pain, intermenstrual spotting on and off in the last 2 to 3 months. But she's not planning to get married soon since she's only 19. An examination on per abdomen, that is, we found a 12-week mass. USG showed a 7 by 7 centimeters homogeneous mass suggestive of an adenomyoma and a small ovarian endometriotic cyst. AMH was done outside by her general physician before sending her. That was 1.9. So in these patients, sir, what would be the first line of investigation for such women? What would you say, Nagendra, sir?
Ultrasound is still the mainstay of your investigation, and ultrasound will give you probably everything that you need to know about the endometriosis. Now, about the adenomyosis. Now, the problem is adenomyosis in adolescent many times is accompanied by endometriosis, and in my experience, often by deep infiltrating endometriosis. So that is something which you should pick up at as early as possible. And for that, probably I would err on the side of caution and do an MRI also to be aware of what is existing, what else is, what additional for certain additional findings like deep infiltrating endometriosis of the bowel, etc., etc. And but otherwise, ultrasound still remains your mainstay for initial diagnosis and also for the follow-up during the course of your treatment.
But sir, do you see such a large mass in such young
people? Very unusual. Now, it's very funny. Whatever adolescent adenomyosis I've seen, one of the classical signs that they'll come with is progressively worsening dysmenorrhea. That is one of the very classical signs. And then gradually later on, it will turn into continuous dull pain. And many of times when you see through ultrasound, the commonest type of adenomyosis I have encountered in my practice is cystic form of adenomyosis, you know, with the hemorrhage inside. And they're quite small lesions, 3-4 centimeters like that. And the pain is totally out of proportion with the size of that lesion. And many of times, I don't know if other people agree with me, I find them very close to a round ligament on one side or the other. It's a very interesting finding that I've noted whenever I've done these lesions. Otherwise, whereas other adenomyosis, as we see in the older age group, we see more often on the posterior wall and it is often central. This tends to be asymmetric, more towards the one corner or one side, one near the round ligament. It's a very unusual observation I had. And it's more cystic, it's smaller, and pain is out of proportion.
So when this patient comes to you, sir, in her first visit to the OPD, and you examine her, you find this size of an adenomyoma, what would be your advice to her or counseling to her?
So first thing, of course, she needs treatment. You can't leave it alone. The second issue is that this is a disease which is prone to recurrence. There are two things. One is she'll have to go on to prolonged therapy even if you operate. So the question of the whole purpose of your treatment should be aimed at delaying. You may not be able to avoid the surgery forever, but delaying the surgery as much as possible. So because two things. One is prolonged treatment is necessary even if you do a surgery. Compliance is poor, all of us know. Even doctors won't take treatment for years and years for that matter. Recurrences are very common, so they'll end up with repeat surgery, each surgery being more difficult than the other. So, you know, you can have complications of these repeat surgeries, you can have worsening of the, you know, you can have damage to the uterine cavity, you often end up entering the uterine cavity during the surgeries. So, you know, the whole purpose is, one is try medical therapy first, even if it's a big size lesion, doesn't matter. The whole purpose is to ameliorate the symptoms. At the end of the day. And if the lesion, even sometimes you find the lesion shrinks from say 7 to 5 centimeters, the symptoms are fine, the symptoms are gone, you can continue the medical treatment for a long period of time. So surgery should be deferred.
So sorry. So going ahead with this case, as you can see, she was put on conservative management with COCs, but she did not have any relief with that. Yeah. She was also put on Dynogest for almost 3 to 4 cycles, for which she was only 50% of her symptoms were better, but she was continuing to have persistent chronic abdominal pain. What next in such cases? I mean, how would you like to go further ahead with more conservative management? Would you like to wait on surgery? So,
yes,
since she's not very keen on her further reproductive life as of now.
Yeah. One of the options I have tried in the really drastic cases where pure progestins or OCPs do not work is put them on GnRH analogs. I put them on something like a decapeptyl for 3 months. And in the first month, I have not found many references for this. I add letrozole. So it's a combined therapy. Since we know that these tissues are capable of producing their own aromatase, so the first couple of months, I add letrozole with the GnRH analog. Of course, they get severe menopausal symptoms. But with this, I have found a good substantial amount of decrease in the size of the lesions and in the symptoms. And once the lesion comes down to a particular size, then you can put them long-term onto OC pills. If they can accept, of course, we preferably continuous OC pills or on your progestins. I think progestins, the simplest and the cheapest progestins are always the best. You start with them. If they can't tolerate them, then you go on to more expensive ones like Dynogest. Surgery, again, as I said, it's the patient's desire itself, or then there's no option left. If the lesion is growing, not responding to medical therapy, symptoms are getting worse, then you opt for the surgical part. Or if she has endometriosis additionally, added endometriosis causing symptoms.
Okay. So would you routinely do an AMH on these patients who do not show much of ovarian endometriosis, but they come more of with a picture of adenomyosis at this age group, in the adolescent age group?
No, I would not per se do an AMH preoperatively. Means, frankly, that question of AMH will come only if surgery is going to come and if you're going to operate for endometriosis. So in terms of adenomyosis, AMH really has no role.
Correct. And now this lady already had a report of an AMH of 1.9. So yeah. Would you counsel anything regarding that? She's only 19 and she's yet to start her career. So she's not very keen on listening to anything about marriage or for the reproductive life.
Yeah, then now this is going away from adenomyosis. But yes, one of the options we must discuss with these patients is if they may require surgery for endometriosis, especially the ovarian endometriosis. So one of the things we must counsel her or at least refer her to a fertility specialist regarding the egg freezing.
Right. And role of GnRH, how many months would you like to continue GnRH in this lady?
3 to 6 months. 3 to 6 months, not more than that.
And any supplements you would like to add for her postmenopausal symptoms?
So, because vitamin
19.
So if you are just doing for 3 months, I think calcium with vitamin D is good enough, frankly. If you are going to plan for a longer, in those very refractory cases, you are going to plan GnRH for a longer period of time, say 1 year, 2 years, whatever, then you can consider add back therapy with low dose OCPs. But otherwise, for a 3 month period, 6 month period, really a vitamin D calcium is good enough, more or less.
Okay, so this lady was counseled regarding all the treatment options and she was also told about surgery. She just wanted relief from her pain. So how much does medical management work on such sizes? I mean, we heard Asha ma'am say below 5, we can try medical management, and if she's in the reproductive age group and if she wants to conceive, and beyond 5, go and operate. So how much of medical, reliefs with medical management do we expect with this size of an adenomyoma?
So the problem with adenomyosis is how much is the active component of the disease that is there? How much of the endometrial lining is still there? Because, progressively the endometrial lining, if you see the pathology of adenomyosis, it is part of it is endometrial. There is less amount of muscle, but there is a lot of fibrous and connective tissue, collagen tissue in these lesions. So the question arises, the response depends on how much of active disease, that active endometrium is there within these lesions. And also, if there is more of fibrous tissue, then obviously the response is much less. So, it's paradoxical. So sometimes, but yes, the larger the lesions, the chances of response or long-term and more better response in terms of symptoms is probably going to be poorer. So the larger the lesion, the more likely that she will need a surgery at some point of time.
So suppose you have planned surgery for this patient, would you like to put her initially on GnRH analogs, wait for 3 months? GnRH therapy and then operate, or would you first do surgery and then go for a suppression?
So putting up a GnRH analog for 2 or 3 months doesn't make sense, because it's not going to make that much of a difference to your surgery. The surgery is going to be difficult anyways. You are not going to find planes anyways. So what I do is, I initially give a dose of GnRH analog. In fact, I stopped using GnRH analog too much. I'll tell the reasons why. But what I used to do is, I used to give GnRH analog. Let the flare-up effect go. Let them get a withdrawal and then operate immediately. So whatever little bit reduction in vascularity, it helps us in our surgery. Well, the reason why I have shifted from GnRH and GnRH analogs to Dynagest or OC pills is that one of my worries is that you are causing severe amount of hypoestrogenism and you need some amount of estrogen for tissue healing, for especially myometrial ingrowth, for strengthening of the myometrial scar. So whether you know it, the giving GnRH analog can affect the healing of the scar of the uterus is my main concern. So I would prefer not to give GnRH. In fact, in my recent listing, I don't give GnRH analog. I prefer to put them on the OC pills for that period of time or Dynagest.
Okay.
Because you want the heal. You want the scar to heal. Yeah. Okay.
So in this patient, we went ahead and did a surgery. This was her intraoperative picture. You see a huge adenomyoma. After infiltration, we went ahead, preferred to use scissors and tried to find a plane, which was described by you that it's going to be really difficult to find a plane in such cases. I'll just be fast forwarding a bit of this. So also in surgery, how much of tissue would you prefer resecting, or what would be the landmarks? As Saumil asked by sir, that whether preoperatively you would have a USG marking, knowing how much you're going to resect, or is it just intraoperatively you decide?
So one is, of course, preoperatively, that's where the MRI comes in. So you can map, if it's adenomyoma, you can map the location of the adenomyoma. Second is intraoperatively, one is I take oblique incision, not a vertical, not a transverse incision, oblique incision from convenience of suturing. What I do is, if it's the ball of adenomyosis, I cut in the center, cut till I split the adenomyosis into two halves. You will come to an area where the tissue looks relatively normal. So that is the base of the adenomyoma. So you split it into two halves. Then second is, below each flap, with a monopolar or a ultrasonic scalpel, I start scooping out the adenomyosis like a wedge. Okay. So you create two flaps on either side. So there's an ease of suturing. That is my the way I do it.
And any preferred method of suturing, like interrupted, or would you
So what I do is, if you have two flaps here, I use the Bach suture, take from one side to the other, reverse like a box stitch from the other side below, until from one side to the other, that is your first, the basal layer, then your second layer, and maybe necessary a third layer. That is how I suture it. Because you can't take sutures inside, they will cut through.
Okay. Do you advocate Bach sutures routinely, or is there any specific reason for barbed, or
would it's just convenience, frankly. It's just convenience.
Okay.
But if it's not available, you use number of micron. That is good enough.
Yes. Moving ahead, how would you convince or counsel her regarding future chances of recurrence?
Yeah, you have to tell her
after the surgery.
Recurrences are very common. Recurrences are very common, and each recurrence, the surgery will be more difficult. Chances of fertility being affected are more and more. So I have to impress upon her I just did one case a few days ago, severe endometriosis, uretric endometriosis and adenomyosis. So she was also, I think, about 22, 24 years old. So we have to impress upon them that they have to take long-term therapy. They have to accept those little disadvantages. Like, the most common worry is those irregular periods. All of these patients, all of them are worried about irregular periods and nothing else. But you have to impress upon them that they need to take long-term medical therapy. And the benefits from fertility. So I think once you impress upon that, if you take long-term therapy, your chances of getting pregnant later are higher. So you know, if you put it this way, probably you can convince them better. So that is the
key. Right. And so your role of your ideas on aromatase inhibitors, since it's very recently being started to be used.
So I started using letrozole when it came into the market. You know, there was a phase when it was being used for ovulation induction, then it got banned. So I started using it for endometriosis. If you use aromatase inhibitors alone, what happens is the FSH levels start rising and there's a breakthrough. So they start getting follicular cysts. You know, they get big follicular cysts and symptomatic follicular cysts. So you can't use aromatase inhibitors alone. You have to use them in combination with, you know, some progestin or a GnRH analog. That is the key. But they work very well. So I just use for 1 to 3 months. Sorry. Yeah.
No, no, yeah, exactly that part. How long a period would you use aromatase?
1 to 3 months, not more than that.
Okay, and even in
probably the first, probably the first month is crucial. That 1 month you do acute suppression of the disease, and then I think your progestin or your GnRH unlock can take over after that.
So in such ladies who she's just 19 and she's going to, even after a surgery, she's going to require a long-term suppression, what would be your line of action?
Sorry, long-term suppression, dynogest, progestin. Dynogest or your other, any progestin, or if they want regular menses, you know, then they want menses every 3-4 months or whatever, they've lived accept, then load of those symptoms.
And how long would you prefer using dynogest? I mean, do you have any?
Until now, there is. I have used up to 5 or 6 years. I use in patients to 5 or 6 years quite safely. And there is data. The last study I read was they mentioned about 65 months. So that is quite a substantial period. So beyond that, we don't know.
And about her further reproductive outcome and obstetrical outcome, would you be counseling her right now? Because this is the age group where, I mean, you have a chance to tell them what they can expect in the future.
Yeah, we have to tell them, especially the, you know, the parents and the we have to sit and explain to them that there is a possibility that they may require some assistance, some form of assisted reproduction in the future. So, once they get married, a counseling, you know, immediately when they plan for a pregnancy, you have to go a little one step ahead at every step, whether it's planned relations or your IUI, whatever, you have to go one step ahead. So that active management of these things is important. Well, and the other thing is, of course, the risk of rupture during pregnancy.
So how do you counsel her for the risk of rupture? I mean, it's really far away from where she is right now. And she'll be like, doctor, I've just come for pain.
So that's right. Right now, at that stage, we can't explain these things to them. But that is at a later stage when they plan for a pregnancy. So essentially, I think the key is like when you deal with a myomectomy, you tell them that they require a cesarean section, and certain complications of adenomyosis you have to watch out for during pregnancy.
So any role of selective estrogen receptor modulators? I mean, I've not added the question, but Madam did mention ormeloxifene. That she's been using.
I have used it not in young women, but I have a couple of patients in their 30s, late 30s, and I have used ormeloxifene. It's worked quite well. It's one of my patients has been taking it for almost 6 or 7 years. Now I still, you know, she's a school teacher, and in fact, she was teaching my daughter for some time. So, you know, and it's worked quite well in her. The adenomyosis is growing slightly, millimeter by millimeter, but now 6-7 years, she's asymptomatic. So I said, fine, be. So, you know, It works. It's not that it doesn't work. But the only my problem is with these, you know, these SERMs or these selective progesterone receptor modulators, all these things, it's a very indirect effect.
Correct.
So we don't, you cannot really predict the effect in each individual.
So today we've had a lot of people advocating LNG IUD. Would you consider it in this age group and these ladies? She's 90, adolescent.
A woman of who is sexually active, who is willing, it is not a bad idea, to be very frank. It is not, although I have never used it. Maybe some of my madam or somebody here might have used it in these young girls. But there are, which, you know, when educated women today come, and I have put a property also in some of these, you know, 20 and 25, 4-year-old girls. You know, they come from, they're educated. It's their choice, you know. Right. So all these things should be explained. These are the options available.
Right. Most of them. This post-operatively, or would you try it pre-operatively as well?
What? Sorry.
An LNG. I mean, would you like to say, okay, if these others are not working, let me try LNG, and then maybe push the way for another couple of years.
I would use a LNG in this girl. If, you know, we have proven the efficacy of the progestin. If you are giving oral progestin, maybe injectable progestin, no, and it is working on her, then we can consider on the long term basis. So we have to be reasonably sure that it is going to work. But she's going to pay for that. So that is the only thing.
Would your first option always be COC, or would it be progesterone?
No, COCs. In this age group, COCs. And because with progesterone.
Sorry to interrupt.
No, with progestins, there is an effect on bone mineral density. All of these progestins have been shown to affect bone mineral density which you would not want, you know, problem in this young woman.
So and there are some of these studies which are coming up relating and correlating COCs with deep infiltrating endometriosis in the future. Any experience with that, or any would you still consider COCs in these young women?
I would still consider COCs, the low dose COCs in these women. I would still consider. I know there are studies coming on this, the effect of the possibility to stimulate deep infiltrating endometriosis. But we have to wait and see.
How often would you follow up these women after surgery, and if she's suppressed, how often would you repeat her investigations, or how often
every
would you follow
months.
Up for her ultrasound?
6 months.
Okay,
six months.
Right.
You can't make them panic. You know, you call them every 3 months, 2 months. You know, you can't make them panic. At the same time, you have to be able to reassure them. You know, it's a very stressful period for them. They understand what they're going through, and at the same time, there is a frustration for them that they're facing. They have to live with an incurable disease. Not easy for them. So
this this lady has finished 1 year after surgery, and she's doing pretty well right now on Dynogest. Initially, post surgery, she was started on GnRH, and then she was put on Dynogest once the suppression was achieved. So now she's doing pretty well. She's been pain free, and she's actually working right now, planning to get married next year probably. So coming to the next case scenario, this is an even interesting one. Since it is adolescent adenomyosis, the selection of cases are very precise, and management also depends more on the patient's symptoms and age. We cannot offer her all the options of management that are available for adenomyosis. So she's again a 19-year-old, very newly married lady. She presented with severe dysmenorrhea. Onset of pain 5 days prior to the onset of menses. She was very thin built. Her ultrasound was done outside. She came with the report. She said, "Doctor, I have a 7 centimeter fibroid. I have pain. You please operate me and remove the fibroid." So at that time, would you investigate her further, or would you say, "Okay, you have a report and your symptoms. Okay, let's go for surgery." What would be your thought process if a lady presents with such a report and such symptoms?
First of all, I would do the ultrasound myself. I think as a gynecologist, you do ultrasound, we see the, you know, we can I think sometimes differentiate between the fibroid and adenomyosis. Sometimes, you know, if you just see the plates also, sometimes you feel that instinctive feel, you know, that yes, there's something different, it's not a fibroid. I think that is very important. Okay. I would not go for MR as a thing else. My main thing will be the, you know, yes, and I, of course, if I suspect adenomyosis, then I would also look for endometriosis additionally.
Correct. So this lady was actually taking treatment at an institute wherein she was advised an open myomectomy. So that's why she came saying, "Okay, doctor, you do laparoscopy. I have a fibroid you remove, and I'm having a lot of pain. So operate me." So if you're presented with such a scenario, how would your thought process go?
So as I said, if I do ultrasound, if I see adenomyosis, and if it is about in that borderline 5-6 centimeters size, you know, so then I would still try to suppress that disease. So, you know, although the most of the studies are showing that, you know, when future fertility is concerned, surgery seems to have a marginally better effect on that, I would still consider suppressing the disease initially with GnRH analogs or medical therapy. I would still consider doing that. Okay. So
we repeated the USG. We found a 6x7 centimeter homogeneous mass looking like an adenomyoma or a uterine anomaly, because there was a confusion in the diagnosis. So we sent her for an MRI. An MRI confirmed a focal adenomyoma of 6x7 centimeters on the right uterine wall. So as her age and symptoms were are stating, we put her on OC pills, but she didn't have any relief. We tried her on Dynogest and even a combination of Dynogest and ethinyl estradiol, but in vain. Even GnRH analogs was not working on her. And ultimately, she came with her husband one day, and she said, in fact, she came with her entire family, her in-laws, everybody came along, and she said, "Okay, doctor, that's enough. We have wasted a year now. You've been telling us pain will go. We won't operate. I'm still young, but then I don't care. Now you remove it and I want to be free of this pain." So then what would your further plan be?
Yeah, if medical treatment is not working, then surgery is the only option left. So you have to operate on this momentum with surgery. And yes, I was just going to mention that some you are talking about other pathologies that you can find. So I have done cases where, you know, it has turned out to be a rudimentary horn with adenomyosis, sometimes a didelphic uterus, one horn having adenomyosis. But these are outliers. So, you know, once in a while you can be fooled. In fact, all your investigations, you do MRI, everything, at the end of it, sometimes you go and you find something else.
So how accurate so things can happen. MRIs for uterine anomalies? I mean, how much have you found as a correlation?
It is as accurate as a 3D ultrasound. So, for me, 3D ultrasound, this is the gold standard to verify.
My next question was to be that, Anisha, we had a discussion in the last presentation about elastography and 3D ultrasound. Any role of elastography in such cases?
I am not convinced. I think these are investigations of more of academic interest. Frankly, as I said, you have a clinical, as a clinician, you have the history of the patient, the symptomatology of the patient. You do ultrasound, maybe you want to do a Doppler, fine. But I think just looking at the ultrasound itself, adenomyosis is something which is, you know, it stares out at you, frankly. I think ultrasound is ultrasound in this scenario.
So, based on all this, we went in for a surgery. This was her picture at surgery. So, I'll just forward. You can't make out a very clear focal adenomyoma of 6x7 cm. It was not apparent. But she didn't have any other signs of endometriosis anywhere else. On examination of the right tube, we found that the right tube was pretty thin. It was ballooned out at one edge. The right cornu was more bulging. All this led us to a suspicion whether we are dealing with a uterine anomaly and we should not go ahead and do an unnecessary surgery. We went ahead with an hysteroscopy, and trust me, hysteroscopy was very difficult. I work in an OT in which the chief surgeon is one of the topmost hysteroscopic surgeons, and he had to spend quite a lot of time entering this cavity. And on entering the uterine cavity, as we can see, I've edited the video quite a lot, but I'll just describe it in brief. This is the left horn of the cavity. You can see a left ostia here, whereas the right side cannot be entered. There is the right wall is totally, I mean, it appeared like a unicornuate uterus.
It's a uterine septum.
Yeah, it could have been a uterine septum. We tried to find an opening. We even used the resectoscope scissors to try and puncture to see whether we are missing out on something, but in vain. There was nothing. We even suspected it could be a Roberts uterus or an ACUM. And yeah, we decided that, okay, we have not counseled her for all those surgeries. So let's just wait and we'll counsel them and redo the surgery in a different setting with a fresh set of investigations and with a plan. So the further investigation and management was planned, but due to this was happening in the month of March, and that's when the lockdown started. And then she went to a native place, she came back in October with the same complaints. Then she said, okay, November before Diwali you have to operate me. But she was not getting her menses. Suddenly a couple of weeks back she presented in the OPD again with a positive UPD. So now we are just any specific precautions for pregnancy in such type of uterus, would you say?
Probably be more aggressive about the cerclage. You know, assuming it's a unicornuate cavity, so that watch out for cervical incompetence. Maybe be more aggressive with the cerclage. I think in practice, you know, it's good to say guidelines, watch for this thing. But most of us will end up doing a cerclage in this moment in practice.
Yeah, I had edited that part in the video, but I would just like to mention it. So we did use a resectoscope to try and enlarge the cavity. We were expecting that at some point it would give way and we would find something like an endometriotic cyst in the uterus, like everybody showed in their hysteroscopic videos. But we incised almost 0.5 to 1 centimeter on that side, but still there was no sign of that. That's why we decided to stop the surgery over there and redo it at another sitting. So any specific tips on such surgeries?
For what? Switch surgeries? Are you talking about the
hysteroscopic adenomyoma resection?
Yeah, one is we should have an intraoperative ultrasound. First of all, I think it takes a lot of guts because the problem with the hysteroscopic adenomyoma resection is how to decide the extent of dissection. That is the main key. So I think you have to decide how much. You know, if it's a small adenomyoma, feasible, it is coming close to the cavity, then do it. If it's very large, extending up to the serosa, you want to have multiple sittings. Or, you know, difficult to define the extent of resection. then you may possibly call intrauterine adhesions. Probably it's better to be safer to go laparoscopically. So resection of adenomyoma, by and large, I would reserve it more for women who are, we are doing a hysteroscopy for abnormal uterine bleeding to find that lesion. I would reserve it more for that. Otherwise, I would prefer to go laparoscopically without actually damaging the uterine cavity. And resection is the same way as you do a myomectomy, but you have to always underdo in case of adenomyosis. You have to always underdo. So you have to just, there will be cryptic lesions inside that, with crypts inside with the hemorrhagic fluid. Excise all the crypts as much as possible and leave a margin. And that is the
picture. This picture in front of you, if this is the picture you find, what would be your approach to this case? Would you go ahead and operate? Okay, yeah, I know MRI is telling me it's an adenomyosis. I have to go and excise it. I've counseled.
I'm a little surprised. It's the size. It's totally. It's not correlating. Frankly, the six cells, very 6 cm. This is probably just a bulky uterus from what I can see. So it's very unusual. No, sometimes you can see this in a deeply seated myoma. A deeply seated myoma, you can have this sort of finding. It's very close to the cavity, so the uterus is just slightly expanded. But in the adenomyosis, it's very unusual. Adenomyosis is something which is, it stares out at you. Sometimes, the ultrasound may have mentioned a fibroid. You look at the uterus when you put in the scope, it's adenomyosis you're dealing with.
Okay, with this, I'd like to thank Nagendra sir a lot for answering all these questions so precisely and enlightening us on this such a unique topic, adolescent adenomyoma, which is maybe not many face so frequently. With this, I would like to conclude and thank Ritu Khanna ma'am for this opportunity and Asha Rao ma'am. Thank you very much, seniors. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for the opportunity, madam.
Thank you so much. It was such an excellent presentation, Ramani ma'am. Ramani ma'am is there.
It was indeed, it was a very nice presentation because adolescent adenomyosis is quite rare. But you have rightly pointed out that medical management should be the first line of treatment. And Dr. Nahendra Sardesh, he has done an excellent work by drilling into the minds of the viewers that it should be the medical management. And Dr. Rohan also, you have just rightly stopped the procedure instead of going in for a very invasive procedures. Just, we can go ahead with the conservative management rather than going in for a surgical clearance. And I personally feel even a combination drugs with dynages with gabergoline can also be used because there was one question in the chat box whether gabergoline could be used. Yes, definitely gabergoline could be used because there is again an overexpressed VEGF activity. And then letrozole definitely is a good choice. We can use it from 1 to 3 months, like sir has explained beautifully, but always combined with a progesterone or a GnRH analog in order to reduce the ovarian cyst formation. But we have to be very careful when we are using the drug because when a combination of GnRH with letrozole is going to further augment the reduction in the bone mineral density, that we have to be very careful. Then the third one is we can use LNG IUS in these patients. Initially, when the age of the patient is beyond 16 years, we are justified in using GnRH analogs for 3 doses followed by LNG IUS. There are literature evidence to show that the patient has got definite improvement symptomatically as well as there are literature evidences and even my personal experience that there is definite reduction in the size of adenomyosis. Then once when you remove it and then go for an ovulation and induction with IUI or a simple ovulation induction, the chances of conception are going to be very high. So then they have also brought about the idea of doing a oocyte preservation, fertility preservation in young adolescent girls with endometriosis. I think it is a superb performance by the youngsters as well as the expert opinion from both of the senior consultants.
Thank you wholeheartedly.
Expert pairs did very well.
Yes. Thank you.
Brilliant show and we all sat mesmerized.
Yes, excellent by all four. I think they kept the ball rolling for more than 1 hour and really didn't know where the time has flown again. So thank you so much to both the presenters and the experts. We had a wonderful experience with such discussions going on. And I think every day holds the possibility of a miracle. And to take us away from really this nightmare of adenomyosis. So we should think happy and positive. And before I close, just a lot of questions, but one or two with progesterone as the add-back therapy. It's open to all our learned speakers, and also this, which progesterone do we use as the add-back therapy when you give it with the aromatase? And Dr. Asha, ma'am, is there? Hello, Asha, ma'am.
Yeah. No. It's in the chat box, right? Yeah.
No, I just put it, I just got it across to me, forwarded to me. So, which progesterones as the add-back therapy would you like to add for the aromatase inhibitors for the adenomyosis?
Can you say
I'm
that?
I'm pretty happy with the norethisterone, 5 milligram daily.
Right. Mm-hmm. And there's a question, 19 years old girl with severe dysmenorrhea, ultrasound is normal, how to manage?
Dynagest. Empirical management of dynagest. That's very obvious. You go by the clinical symptoms rather than the other findings.
And long-term use, as Dr. Nagendra also pointed out, can we give one OCP for one cycle with Marina? Dr. Seema Mehta said. Can we give OCP for one cycle with Marina?
Yeah, backup. To prevent the breakthrough bleeding, the initial phase, it can be supported with the oral contraceptive pill. One or two cycles.
Yeah, you can even give a simple progesterone with that, like norethisterone.
Right.
Can be given.
Any role of micronized progesterone, Dr. Lata Shukla?
I feel like micronized progesterone not as good as the norethisterone or norethindrone.
But it has a place in when you use anastrozole. Textbook description is when you want to add a progesterone, we can give micronized progesterone every day.
More expensive, you know?
Much expensive.
More expensive.
Yeah, that's there. Just to answer what the query I'm telling.
We have to tell both sides of the coin.
Yeah.
And the difference between an endometrial cyst and a corpus luteal cyst, I think the ultrasound is the best answer to that.
And elastography plays a role in that. You can't differentiate CL cyst from endometriotic cyst.
So I think we've lots, but we've covered a lot of things into all our discussions, and we are just flying out of the time and we need to close the session. So before I close, I'm really, really short of words to thank our chief guest, Dr. Suchitra Madam, who's been with us throughout the session. And it was a pleasure, and guest of honor, Dr. Lakshmi Ma'am, for giving us your blessings, the backbone, the heart, the mind, the soul behind this program, Dr. Ramani Devi Ma'am and Dr. Asha Rao, Dr. Learned Speakers, Dr. Manju Kamani, Dr. Asha Rao, Dr. Vidya Bhatt, the brilliant presenters we had, Somil and Rohan, and the stalwarts, our experts, Dr. Muralidhar Pai and Dr. Nagendra Sadesh Pandey, for sharing us your pearls of your knowledge. And the esteemed chairpersons have really given us such valuable inputs, and they've made this session so lively and interactive, and have given us all your precious time. Thank you also to all the delegates who are with us for all the cooperation and the active participation, and which made this venture really, really successful. And not ending before giving my thanks to the talk team, Sana and Shishan, and really the beautiful conduction of this webinar and giving us this knowledge sharing platform. Thank you once again, Ramani ma'am, Asha ma'am, and all the speakers and all the presenters also. Thank you.
Continuation of this, we will be having the third talks webinar exclusively on infertility and endometriosis, and we have good speakers and including international speakers. It will be on June 4th of January between 3 and 5 p.m. I request every one of you to join the program. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you, Ramani. Good night.
Thank you.
Thanks all.
Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Thank you, everybody.